Big Brother, mainstream media, government cover-ups. You want answers? Well, so does he. He's Alex Jones on the GCN Radio Network. And now, live from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, get ready because, well, I'm wound up and there is a lot to cover, and it just continues to illustrate everything we've been talking about. There is a private, anti-free market, anti-family world government being established that calls itself the New World Order. It's just modern slavery, where the globalists are exempt from taxes, exempt from their own laws that they internationally create, codify, and then get our dictatorial governments of every major nation to certify. So we're going to be breaking all of this down today. Lew Rockwell of lewrockwell.com will be joining us via video Skype, and we'll take some of your calls as well in the third hour. And we are also going to have Pat Shannan on. He was going to be on a few weeks ago, but it was so much breaking news, I moved him. I've known this guy for like 16 years, 17 years. And an amazing investigative journalist. He's written a new book that I couldn't put down when I started reading it. Everything They Ever Told Me Was a Lie, available at InfowarsStore.com. And we're going to be going over his book and a lot more today in the second hour. And we'll also have open phones then. Wow, where do I start? Where do I begin? There's been something really eating at me. I've talked about it some, but not enough. And so we're going to do a series of investigative reports on this, just illustrating the fact for you. The facts are in, but we'll put it together in the reports. I'm going to talk about it today, but it almost doesn't do justice to it. It's like if I do a special report on the nightly news and then air it here, everyone pays attention to it and it like has some type of special gravitas. But if I'm just here going over the mountains of information, it tends to kind of fall on deaf ears sometimes. But there is no doubt, and it has been stated, that the government, for any reason, no judge, no jury, is not just planning to not let you travel outside the country or back into the country, vis-a-vis however they choose, or take your bank accounts, but that the government is moving to not even let you travel within the country or have a job. In fact, I printed it last week and meant to get to it. I just type in Obama's new executive order to seize bank accounts. It's huge bombshell news. And see, I already know all this is coming. So what happens is I read this news, I confirm it, and then I don't even cover it a lot of the time because it's passe to me. Well, just because you know that you're being taken to the gallows at 5 a.m. Doesn't change the fact that you're being taken to the gallows. And our country is being walked to the gallows pole. And I do not like it. So we're going to be going over just news of the last couple days. This is just what I came in this morning and dug out of today's stack and the stack from over the weekend. Okay? This is just out of the stack from today. And when we come back, I'll mention some of the other news that's coming up today. It's a big news day. Very important news. AP, no-fly list, trans man on island in Hawaii. I'm proud of the fact that days before this last week, last Wednesday, and this came out on Friday, it was Doug Hagman who told us about this, and we got the guy on the show repeatedly and were able to force it out. And now here's the AP days later admitting that because he's a prepper and because he complained about the NDAA online, well, now you just can't fly, bud. How's that sound? You're a U.S. citizen, no judge, no jury. No judge, no jury. And he just says, you know, you're just disappeared. That's just the beginning. Now, here's Lew Rockwell, why you need a passport now. They're moving to just deny Americans passports for no reasons. Oh, the IRS, you're not going anywhere. Fox News. Senators unveil Ex-Patriot Act, expand to Facebook's severance tax scheme. We're going to break down what life in America and the Western world will be like if we don't stop these authoritarians. That's why the TSA is at the heart of all this. Also, UN monitors are here to oversee the election. That and a lot more coming up. Gentlemen, it is Monday, the 22nd day of October 2012. And we are going to be here for the next 3 hours, investigative journalist, author, to cover a myriad of important issues and break some important news. Will be joining us in the second hour. Then Lew Rockwell, Ron Paul's former chief of staff, to give us his take on the differences between Puppet A and Puppet B, Barack Obama, and, of course, Mitt Romney. And I've got a big stack of them here. Every scientific big poll, Gallup, you name it, has him now in a dead heat or 3 to 5 points ahead of Obama. And I went back and looked at it. Also found another article going over it from Gallup showing their polling over the last 2 weeks. And, yeah, it shows him 2 weeks ago, Romney 49, Obama 47. And now you can just see it change the numbers up till now. Obama 45, Romney 52. And that's what a bunch of other polls are showing. Now listen, don't count your chickens before they're hatched if you like Romney. Because there's something called electronic voting fraud that has been proven to really be bad in more than 10 states. And it varies county to county, but 10 states are really been certified to be full of fraud. Places like Ohio, Florida, basically anywhere that's been a swing state before. Iowa in primaries, California. Do not hold your breath, ladies and gentlemen. And again, it'll just mean a different management team from the New World Order if Romney gets in. Christian Science Monitor has an analysis out today saying that Romney couldn't really have a tougher Iran policy with sanctions and covert operations than Obama would. And that's really true from my research. Kurt Nemo, a day before that, had an article out. Obama and Romney, war no matter who wins election. Well, yeah, people say, oh, Alex, where's this war? I don't know, Libya, I mean, no, they called it a peace action. Syria right now, blowing up missile factories, blowing up military police bases on a weekly basis, assassinations inside Iran. Our media bragging that there's covert war going on. I mean, that's war. You know, when you're blowing up military bases in Iran, that's called a war, just in case people didn't know. There's war's been going on for really 3 years. Hot and heavy, but it's starting to intensify. It was kind of like on level 5 on the top of the stove. Now they turned it up to level 10. So it is on high burn right now. The only question is, will it go into overdrive and turn it up to broil? So we're going to be breaking all that down. Also on the election, you into monitor conservative groups at U.S. polls. That's Melissa Melton, Infowars.com. And it's also in the Hill newspaper that covers Capitol Hill. International monitors at U.S. polling spots draw criticism from voter fraud groups. And see, the U.N., it's the U.N., when you read it, it says it's the U.N. I mean, look, we told everybody the U.N.'s starting to run our country more and more. Can we just be honest about it, or does the media always have to say, oh, it's global governance, not government? Same thing, though. Or, oh, yeah, it's international monitors. Yeah, from the U.N., but we're not going to say that in the headline because that sounds conspiratorial. I saw that Financial Times of London article, another one pushing world government a few months ago, and it's like, yeah, we don't want to be conspiracy theorists, but there is a global private corporate government, and it knows best, and it's authoritarian. But don't listen to the conspiracy kooks that say there's a world government. So the message is, hey, there's a world government, get in line with it, or we're going to call you a conspiracy theorist because the general public's dumbed down. That's what they're telling business readers. Yes, it's real, but you're not supposed to say it is. Well, the problem is I'm not going to play along with it. Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.com, Matt Drudge at DrudgeReport.com and his crew aren't going to go along with the so-called establishment saying they're going to lecture us on reality. WorldNet Daily is not going to go along with it. Many others aren't going to go along with it. You're not going to go along with it. And so they got a problem because we have inalienable rights. We're not slush. And I live in a city, we've done news reports showing the UN website where they brag, they call it a immunized UN model city, and the city of Austin has signed agreements and policy guidelines to even get international funds and designations. There's our city and one other Japanese city, you can look it up, that are the UN models of the world. And then that Japanese city is our sister city. So Again, you can go watch Aaron Dykes and Melissa Melton's reports. They followed like three of them in the last month. We should air those again. We did during the special 48-hour broadcast. But the point is that it even hit me yesterday driving along with my wife, and I just said, I've got to go on air and explain to people we're in occupied territory. And she goes, you've said that many times. But, I mean, I need to explain this is really happening. This is really going on. I mean, I'm not just saying deep behind enemy lines in captured FEMA Region 6. I live more than anybody else in the United States under the United Nations. We're going to do more reports on that. And every small town around Austin is in the process of being taken over. I mean, they'll go into small towns with 10,000 people in them and spend $5, $6, $7, $8 million a year in the last few years, going in, buying the mayors, buying everybody, pushing a referendum, putting armies of bureaucrats, knocking on doors, having town hall meetings, saying sign on to this. And then they just roll over and just take the land. I mean, you name it. I mean, it's incredible. But they do it in a limp-wristed, simpering NPR voice, which is scientifically crafted under Delphi technique. We'll say to these people, you're Delphi trained. They'll start smiling. I've had them off record laugh at me and say, you're not going to stop us. These are soldiers, folks. These are operatives. These are infiltrators. And they know it is the thing. I've been to smart growth conferences when the camera's off and have one of them just grab me by the shirt. Bankers, former Dallas Cowboy, you name it. They're all there. Bank of America, all of them. And they'll say, you don't ever aim that camera at me. You understand? You're not going to stop anything we're doing. I mean, they know what they're doing. And, I mean, I've witnessed it. They're not naive, folks. These are pirates. But 21st century pirates act all nice and, oh, hi, everybody. Oh. I mean, it's a program. These are spies. These are operatives. And I don't know how I get this across to you, that the fact that the general public reads the newspaper, you know, 23% of people read newspapers still, and then they think they're smart, and that's a bunch of gobbledygook, or they tell the truth, but then lie by omission or frame things differently and say one thing is another, while incredible historic things are happening. We are now in occupied America by the globalists, by the banksters, and just type in banks declare they've conquered Europe, or Goldman Sachs conquers Europe, or Goldman Sachs conquers Greece, or J.P. Morgan conquers the world, and you'll get Forbes and Reuters and AP and all of it. And Davos, Switzerland, I mean, they announced 2 years ago, year and a half ago, the Davos before last, they said, we're going to have a world government with $100 trillion funding us of carbon taxes, and it will be funded into our systems. And even if the carbon taxes fail, we're going to have a new global currency. We're not going to get rid of the other currencies. We're just going to devalue them until you beg for the new strategic drawing right. Guys, just type in $100 trillion, Davos, $100 trillion needed for credit system. $100 trillion. $100 trillion, where the mega bank of Europe, you know, the ECB of Europe, it is the world government now. They, in their own words, Herman Van Rompuy, all of them have bragged about it. He left as the head of the EU and went to be the head of that. They're all there in front of everyone announcing world government. And I'm sitting here going, they're announcing world government. There it is, London Telegraph. World needs $100 trillion more credit, says World Economic Forum. 63 trillion pounds given to them. And what's the date on that? I know it was 2011. It'll be right there. January 18, 2011, as I said, a little over a year and a half ago. And you can go, they got links to the video in there last time I read that article. I mean, this is not my opinion. By the way, I've been listening to syndicated and local talk radio a lot when I'm out jogging and things. I heard WOAI last Friday when I was taking a break jogging when I left here, the big talk station in San Antonio, one of the big ones, saying it's terrible that our government's backing Al-Qaeda in Libya and Syria. And this morning I heard on News Radio 590 them admit and go, yo, it's true. Our government runs Al-Qaeda and it's terrible. So, look, we can get this info out there. I know it doesn't compute with the normal. It's like, well, the government runs Al-Qaeda. Well then, why are they trying to take our liberties? Because it was always a bait and switch. It was always meant to be a bait and switch. And you've got to come to grips with it. I mean, I've been at these Smart Grow conferences and things, and I've had people come over who are in the city and literally look around when nobody's around while I'm by the water fountain and bump into me and say, I'm going to kill you. And you look at them and you're like, you're going to kill me? Yeah, I'm a Marine. I know how to kill you. Well, okay, go ahead and try. You better hope I don't see you coming, buddy. And just because you get me doesn't mean people aren't going to come for you. But you think my family's going to roll over to somebody putting a hole in me? I may not be anything compared to my Texas ancestors, but you mess with me, you better believe people are coming for you. That's another reason I'm still alive. All right, we'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen. Stay with us. I'm going to get into the biggest news, and then I'm going to get into the economy, war. Yeah, I've got something to say about Lance Armstrong. I'm going to get into Russell Means dead. God rest his soul. He's gone on to the happy hunting ground. Stay with us. Well, Obama is now on record, and the media is starting to pick it up. He wants to not only ban rifles, but also handguns, and put citizens extrajudicially on a list and just take your guns. No judge, no jury, no nothing. Just, well, you're on a no-fly list. You're also on a no-buy list. And again, 10 years ago, I was watching C-SPAN for more than an hour and a half, and they had a TSA, Governor Ridge was there. He hadn't even gotten cabinet position yet for Homeland Security, newly formed by the executive. And they had all these tables together with all these corporate CEOs there. And they said at that meeting that in the future, you will have to have TSA, Homeland Security authorization to have a job anywhere. And that they would start in critical infrastructure, computers, ports, and fan out from there. And now you can go look at literally tens of millions of Americans, people that do, you know, service on trucks at national parks, people that work in mining, people that work in basically every area are told, you got to go get a certification. Doesn't matter, your background check came back from Homeland Security. And then they just put a block on you. And you see, this is the essence of tyranny. Every authoritarian system makes you have a paper that's stamped and certified that you're in good standing with them. And then if you're not a good globalist, if you're not a good Nazi, if you're not a good communist, if you're not a good Roman, if you weren't a good Aztec, whatever the case was, you weren't allowed. In England, in the Middle Ages, also in Europe, they had laws about what you could wear. Certain colors, because they didn't have to have checkpoints. If you had a bunch of finery and diamonds and were wearing purple or scarlet, then you were just, boom, access wherever you went. You were known by your horse. You were known by, and you could be executed in ancient England if you were wearing a knight's sword and were not a certified knight. And if you didn't have all the secret passcodes, and that's where secret societies come from, the Masons, all of that. And that's what happens here. Well, now if they just turn your face scan off, your thumbprinting off, and they know it's going to be a giant chilling effect. You serve the system, you're going to be left alone. It's now been in the news, and I've interviewed some of the Marines and people they've done this to. They always want soldiers to infiltrate groups and basically set them up or be set up themselves, that you get put on a no-fly list when you have no criminal record. They always target people that they know are salesmen and folks that have to be able to fly. And they call you in 6 months later. They've got a formula when you're basically bankrupt. And they say, listen, we're going to pay you the money back and everything. You've just got to work for us now in InfraGuard. And we may never ask you to do anything, but we may ask you to kill people. That's come out in the news about InfraGuard. Or we may ask you to go set people up. Now, we're going to pay you. We're going to pay the money you've lost from being on the no-fly list. I mean, this is what they do. This is how they induct people. And a lot of people get scared and they go, well, you're FBI. Okay. You're ATF. Well, all right. I'll do whatever. And then, you know, a couple years down the road, if they find out you're doing things like they want, you're taking over to pure dark side of government, which is now bigger than the light side. Many experts like Joel Skousen break down, and I agree with his analysis. And I mean, if you'll do anything, you're going to be a drug dealer. Or if you'll go, you'll be a killer. Or if you'll go even further, it's unlimited. I went and saw Loopers last night, and I'm going to get more into this big issue of not being able to travel out the country or come back in if they want when we come back from break. I went and saw it. It's a real subtle movie with Bruce Willis. Very, very well done. And in the future, the United States is run by the mafia. And subtly, it shows that the police, by the end, that the mafia is in a police station, and they've actually got cops in blue that you see at the end that are working for the mafia, and the police chief is the gangster mafia chief sent from the future, spoiler alert, obviously, living in a vault inside the building. And the United States is fully collapsed because of corruption, and China is now the center of the world government. But there is still a Second Amendment, so everybody's shooting and killing each other, and more than half the population is homeless. That's actually Agenda 21. But they plan to fully convert the police over. Oh, and it's even more realistic. Low-level cops aren't allowed to have weapons. Then mid-level are allowed to have a single-shot shotgun, and the higher-ups have automatic weapons and everything else. That's actually State Department memorandum and common law, U.S. law 7277, State Department memorandum 7277, and U.N. treaty that we've covered here before. It says the general cops are going to be disarmed and just have tasers. I mean, that movie, that is predictive programming. Either they're pure New World Order, or it was there to condition us, or they were good guys that got this out. Of course, even if they're good guys, they were just allowed to put it out to still condition people. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Big news straight ahead. Live, ladies and gentlemen, and everyone ends up being taken to the gallows pole. Death is part of life, and it is what unifies us all, life and death. All of us will taste of death. Russell Means died over the weekend. American Indian activist, actor, dies at 72. He was supposed to die like a year ago of cancer, but beat it with natural means, then it came back metastasized. Russell Means never shunned attention, whether leading Native Americans and rallying against broken federal treaties, appearing in Hollywood blockbusters, or advocating sovereign American Indian nation with U.S. borders. The activist who helped lead the 1973 uprising at Wounded Knee revealed, reveled in the spotlight. I love how they, in this AP article, you know, imply he was an attention whore. How about being in there for weeks in Wounded Knee when they were pouring tens of thousands of bullets into it? And again, I don't agree with some of the things that Russell Means promoted 20, 30 years ago. But more and more, he was speaking out against the New World Order, against socialism, against collectivism. He understood it was eugenics-based. He said Obama was bad 4 years ago. He had a lot of courage. And we did a big hour-long plus mini-documentary with him that he said was, he thought, the best, you know, sit-down interview he ever did. He was very, very proud of it. It was called Welcome to the Reservation. It's free online. It's posted in high def at prisonplanet.tv. He is, you know, now dead. So Russell Means, who gained international notoriety, is one of the leaders of the 71-day armed occupation of Wounded Knee in South Dakota in 1973, and continued to be an outspoken champion of American Indian rights. After launching a career in action, an actor in films and television in 1990, has died. He's also a great actor, great presence. And there's just a lot of haters and a lot of people that were jealous and envious of Russell Means and the fact that he actually spoke his mind. And the left turned against him in the last 15 years because he began to understand that socialism and communism was a system of enslavement and eugenics to control people and destroy them. And he started speaking about that and exposing that. And so the left started attacking him as well as the fake right. So happy trails, buddy. There in the happy hunting ground, I guess we'll all end up there if we're lucky enough instead of the other place. So God bless you. And tonight on the Nightly News, we're going to air the originals, like over a year and a half old, Welcome to the Reservation after the news. But first we'll air my last interview with him. What was that, about 6 months ago? It was about 6 months ago from the Nightly News as well. That's tonight, 7 o'clock Central. The main news portion tonight will be David Knight. Does a fabulous job. And then we'll air that. By the way, we said we were going to air some Bob Chapman during the 48-hour broadcast. Ever did that? I do in the future want to do a rebroadcast someday on a holiday or something with nothing but Bob Chapman and then me telling stories and leading in and out as a tribute. Because we need to not just forget people that have died, myself included. We're so busy with our own daily lives that interesting people that have contributed to humanity, even though with everything they said, they had courage, they had guts, and that was enough. We need to remember these people. Not just remember all the fake sports icons and things the globalists build up so they can tear them down. And I want to talk about how they can try to control heroes a little bit towards the end of the hour after I get into some more of the news that is coming up. Okay, let me just give you some of the headlines before I get back into the domestic checkpoints that are not coming. They're already here. But what life will be like here in America. Let me just get into some of the other headlines here. Eugenics and education. Healthy boy banned from public school due to genetic makeup. And this has been covered by Fox News, you name it. 11-year-old California schoolboy named Coleman Chatham has been banished from his school and forced to transfer to another school because he carries the genetic mutation for cystic fibrosis. It's not communicable. It's not a, you know, it's a genetic disorder. And it's not even manifesting, but you've got to go to our special. And you notice the special schools are getting in some areas as big as the regular schools because they're the vaccines, the drugs, the chemicals, the bad diets. More and more of the kids are going to have problems. The school gets more money. So why do they even know his genetic makeup? Well, they take your blood at birth. People are going to get genetic testing now, you've noticed. And they'll say, oh, we have a genetic treatment for you. We can probably cure your cancer or whatever it is. But, oh, yeah, they got a blood sample from you sometime in your life. This company patented your particular blood DNA. That's not a joke. Look that up. And sorry, the treatment's going to cost $1 million now. Well, it's going to cost $20,000. I mean, just type that in. Court rules that you don't own your DNA. Okay, they're just doing whatever they want. So there it is. What we're seeing here is the beginning of the application of eugenics in public schools. This is how it starts, banning little boys and girls because of bad gene sequence, even though they have absolutely no symptoms and are living in a state of perfect health. Well, what do they want to go to that school? Next, it progresses to racially genetic profiling with declaration that people have certain races are genetically inferior. That already happens in Endgame. We have in state board hearings in the legislature. They say, why do you drug 69% of kids? And they go, they have bad gene pools. No test is done. They're black. Just, you can't make this up. And therefore, unable to be taught in public schools, will be told. And from there, as history has shown, it moves to the eugenics phase. That's right. Now they say they're going to drug all the kids. Total nightmare. And Mike Adams at naturalnews.com. It's also up at Infowars.com. Links through to Fox News, Daily Mail, HBO. Bill Maher saying, just kill everybody. You know, he's pro-death. Yeah, very nice people. India may ban GMO crop field trials for 10 years. But that's okay. Now, six largest pesticide corporations funding effort to try to defeat GMO labeling Proposition 37. Because you shouldn't be able to know if something's had a bunch of high-tech pesticides sprayed on it or low-tech like fluoride, sodium fluoride. You shouldn't be allowed to know that in America. No, you shouldn't be allowed to know that. That's another report in that area. Pesticide can be the culprit in bee drop-off. New big study out on that. University study, flu vaccine effectiveness claims are wildly exaggerated. And it only helped people 1.5% of the time when the study was looked at by the University of Minnesota. And that's even using the Cook data they had. The flu shot actually lowers your immunity. That's been proven in so many studies it makes my head spins. Another great S.D. Wells story at Natural News. Side effects of GMOs. Ask your doctor, is cancer right for you? Excellent article up at Infowars.com and NaturalNews.com. Pesticide food timeline. And it goes over the Nazis and everything else. You might want to go read that. Or maybe ask your doctor if organ failure is good for you, is right for you. Study says children with ADHD like taking antipsychotic drugs. That's right. They put out a new study saying, hey, and it's good for them once you get them on Ritalin to put them on Prozac. They like it. Well, yeah. What are they? 5 to 7 to 10, depending on the study, are more likely than being drug addicts when you ever put them on any of this? Well, of course, they're getting them young. Got to fight drugs. I mean, dare to stay off drugs, unless they're big pharma's deadly drugs. Also, a lot of reports out today pushing that there's going to be a cyber digital 9/11. Yep, just as soon as Cybersecurity Command is in place to take over, it will then launch the attack, or launch the attack through puppets they covertly hire, who don't even know they've been hired, later bust those puppets as a way to totally take over the web. And I'm now hearing radio ads about, under the new compliance rules, you must save all your email for years and have federally approved IT people. You could go to jail if you don't. Check this federal website to find out. It's already begun. It's all being phased in here. We're spying on you. Better love it. Great video from KXII that we'll get to later when Pat Shannan is on with us. 12-year-old exercises Second Amendment. When I saw the door handle turn, I shot him. More and more children are protecting themselves with firearms, and the system absolutely hates it. Don't you wish somebody at that Wisconsin spa where the angry boyfriend went in and shot people had been armed? But no, it was a bunch of disarmed women. I love how the feminists say women shouldn't own guns. I thought she wanted women empowered. Oh, I see. You really don't. So we're going to be getting into all of that as well. Again, UN monitors to control our elections. It'd be overseeing them, but not overseeing for electronic institutional government fraud, not comptroller fraud, not CEO fraud, not the big industrial fraud. No, they're going to be there making sure the illegal aliens can vote not once, not twice, but thrice, as Democratic operatives have been recorded saying, yes, we'll teach you how to vote repeatedly. That's all coming out. By the way, what was it, a CBS News channel? I had it here in my stack. I'll get to it. Here it is. CBS News affiliate calls 2012 presidential race for Barack Obama weeks ahead of election. And this continues to happen sometimes on the night of the event. What was it, ABC in 96 flashed the exact voting totals hours before for the entire country up on screen and then didn't even change it later to still put it up. The 2012 presidential election is still more than 2 weeks away, but on Friday, a CBS News affiliate in Arizona called the race for President Barack Obama. That's the Daily Caller reports. For 17 seconds, Phoenix, Arizona, CBS News, KPHO, ran a lower third graphic that showed the Obama had won the November 6th election over Governor Mitt Romney with 99% of the precincts reporting. The lower third graphic appeared at 3:30 p.m. on October 19th. During an episode of the People's Court. Got that a little too comical. They said they'd already blown up Building 7. They said it had already fallen its own footprint an hour before it happened, and then 25 minutes before, and the reporters are, it fell in its own footprint from fires. Everyone's surprised that the complete collapse hadn't happened yet. You guys ready? Get going there. Oh, very loving. The CBS News graphic showed Obama winning the election with 43% of the vote nationwide to Romney's 40%. With 40,237,000 votes to 38 million and change for Romney. It is unclear who garnered the other 70% in the fictional election results. KPHO's general manager did not return the Daily Caller's request for comment by the time of publication. So there you go from the Daily Caller reporting on that. Okay, let's just continue here now. Now, I want everybody to listen to me very, very carefully. I want to explain to you what life in this country and in every industrialized nation is going to be like. And this isn't my opinion. This is the stated facts by Homeland Security, by MI5 in England, and by the EU, quote, security services, who all meet and have all integrated their programs. That's why they got naked body scanners going in Europe. Same ones here. It's continuity of agenda. It's a global corporate agenda that is then handed down to the North American Union, the EU, and the Asian Union, which are all open and publicly operating. And deciding everything from the color of street signs down to what the world reserve currency will be, it's all standardized. I want to read to you a few headlines and then tie them in together. Okay, this is just in the last few days. AP, no fly list trans man on island in Hawaii. Because he was a prepper and, well, a threat fusion center said you got a website or he's been seen talking about prepping. No violence, no nothing. You're not allowed to fly. Okay, that's it. We told you about that days before it broke. The Northeast Intelligence Network got him on for us. Okay, Lew Rockwell reports why you need a passport now. And it links to all the mainstream news saying that you are not going to be allowed to have a passport if they feel like it. They're just going to deny you and not say why. No judge, no jury. So there's no fly list that they're talking about. We can document cam shot right in here. Right in here is now the document cam shot sector. You can just keep the camera aimed right there, and we'll show people that right there. So again, right here, no fly list, strands man on island in Hawaii. And if you're talking about document cams and our radio listener, we're streaming video of this at prisonplanet.tv. There's this report. Why you need a passport now? At a future point, it may be impossible to get one. PapersPlease.org reports on what the State Department is planning for future passport applicants. The new U.S. passport application forms are back worse than ever, ignoring massive public opposition, and despite having recently admitted there is already using the proposed forms illegally without approval, the State Department is trying again to get approval for a pair of impossible-to-complete new passport application forms that would, in effect, allow the State Department to deny you a passport simply by choosing to send you either of the long forms. And it goes over the new rules asking who the doctor was that delivered you, who the nurse was, everything, with proof. You have to get a private investigator to be able to get this, okay? Meanwhile, illegal aliens are all just given them instantly, are all legalized everywhere. People say, oh, we need internal checkpoints for the illegals. The illegals are left alone. This whole internal system is for you. So again, people stranded, can't fly because they're a prepper. Told you shouldn't have criticized the NDAA on this blog. You're not flying by weirdo TSA people who are now going to be on the streets. Here's Fox News right here. Oh, the IRS, you're not going anywhere. A bill making its way through Congress could allow the federal government to prevent Americans who owe back taxes from leaving the country. No judge, no jury, no adjudication, private collection agency for the private Federal Reserve. There it is. Okay? You've got that right there. Here's another one. This is ABC News. Senators to unveil Expatriate Act to respond to Facebook's severance tax scheme. Paid his taxes, left the country. All the elites are running to places like Singapore. And this is all selectively enforced, though. Now, little people try to get their legal money out. They're not letting people get 100 thou out that's after-tax money. And they say these are capital controls. This is what always happens. Nazi Germany, Soviet Russia, Maoist China, Fidel's Cuba, Hugo Chavez's Venezuela. Go look at North Korea. Go look at any authoritarian country. This is the hallmark because they're going to not let you get your money out and they're going to take everything you've got. And they mean business. And so what if hundreds of thousands of police die in a civil war? They call them cannon fodder. They call them dumb animals, as Henry Kissinger called them. And a lot of them will line up and die taking you and your family to a FEMA camp because they like being called dumb animals. Now, let's continue here. Let's go right. But this is authoritarianism. This is Red Dawn takeover. We've been occupied. They're trying to mop up free speech right now and shut us down. You better recognize the attack. Okay? Continuing. I've got a bunch of other articles here in my stack dealing with all of this that we're going to be going over and how it ties in with the TSA straight ahead. But you need to understand, the airport is what every place is going to be like. Street corner, the mall, you're not going to have a job unless they say so. Buy nor sell, face scanning to buy and sell. Again, Alex Jones back here live. Thank you for joining us on this Monday edition. This is not my opinion. This is an authoritarian takeover worldwide where they're going to come in your house without warrants. They're going to taser you for no reason. They're going to take blood at checkpoints. It's already started. They're going to make you eat GMO. They're going to force inoculations on you. It's all been announced. They're going to drug all children like THX1138. All children will be drugged. The food's already drugged. The water's already drugged. And they will start just killing people whenever they want on the streets. Drones and blimps will be tethered over every major city. People will start dying. You think 3,000% increases in cancer? How about 10,000, 20,000? And they're just going to start killing everybody. I mean, I guess that's kind of the good news, is that once they get this post-industrial system rolling, most people are going to be dead. If the globalists actually implement all this, remember, there's the good track of history and the bad track. The bad guys are always trying to do this. They want to get rid of freedom because they can't realize their great dreams of total power. It's a paradox that they can't have total power if they don't totally enslave. Even though it ruins the world for them, to them it's beautiful, so they don't mind it. Even if they're destroyed by it, it's like a lot of criminals like to rob and rape and kill because it's fun. It's just not the money. It's that's what they're into. They think that's cool. And so they've warped society. Torture is good. Secret arrest is good. The family's bad. Hurting your body is cool. This is a society begging for enslavement, and you will get it. You will get it. Do not worry. You're going to have a horrible time, everybody. And people will just further get into the sports, get into the drama, all of it. So I'm going to cover this more with Pat Shannan, but a few of the articles here. Again, senators unveil Expatriate Act, where you can't come back to the country if you leave the country with even legal money. Oh, the IRS, you're not going anywhere. Fox News won't let you leave. They're not going to let you operate domestically, they've said as well. No fly list, trans man on island in Hawaii because he was, quote, a prepper, they told him. Now AP confirms what we told you last week. Why you need a passport now? They're set to make you answer questions that are impossible to answer, and they say they'll just start denying them. We already have less passports in the U.S. than any other country in the world. Americans do. They want to keep that going on. Wall Street Journal, wary Swiss banks shun Yanks. You want to put a little money back in the safest banking system in the world? Have your own debit card over here? Used to be UBSs all over the U.S. They're leaving. Because now the U.S. is going in saying, hey, we're going to take over your banks. It's not the U.S. It's the mega bankers. Dutch Royal Shell, BP, Bank of America, Goldman Sachs, J.P. Morgan, Google, General Electric. You've all heard they pay zero or maybe up to 5% tax because they're all exempt. It's people trying to put $1 million in a Swiss bank account of the Caymans. You're not going to do it. It doesn't matter if it's legal. The IRS is going to take what you got out of that bank account and give it to the bankers to put it back in the same bank account. When Scott Smith finally got his Swiss passport last month, it was time for him to take the drastic step. See, they know Americans are leaving, folks, because this ain't land of the free, home of the brave. It's land of the potbelly control freak working for foreign bankers. See, he tried to run to where the mega banks are based in many cases. Well, that's for them to be safe, not for you. You're going to stay here and everything you got taken. We're gonna, maybe the globals put you in a ditch and take care of you and take everything you got, boy. Hey, you might be bad. Among the reasons was a pending U.S. regulation, pending, aimed at tracking down tax cheats that is making life difficult for some Americans abroad. These expatriates say the foreign banks, which have expressed concern over compliance costs and potential penalties for failing to report the American clients, are turning away their business. Oh, yeah. Oh, no. You're an American? Your Fuhrer doesn't let you leave. No. The long arm of the New World Order. See, the globalists have captured America. Now they're using it to capture everybody else. And I got another big stack of news here on this show. That's the future. The TSA shooting you in the back of the ditch and taking your wife and children away for re-education. That was not hyperbole if you just were listening in the last segment. That's what they're training, the Explorer Scouts, the Yugen, the last 5-6 years. That's what they're training the police, the military, the lockdown cities, go door to door and face scan people off their driver's license photos and put people that don't submit to the system. If you're on a no-fly list for being a prepper, you're going to go to a forced labor camp. And that's what they've got in the civilian inmate labor camp program. Just type in civilian inmate labor camp program. It's the Army runs it. They've primed it with federal and state prisoners. They've got them all trained. You're going to go to a forced labor camp. Because, see, that's about the governing class and the bankers having real power. You're going to a forced labor camp. You know, George Soros helped hunt down his fellow Jews in Romania and identify them and take their money. And, you know, the globalists here today are saying we're going to have capital controls. I've seen people with a couple silver coins drug out of line, you know, on the airplane, at the airport. This is the system. This is what they're doing. This is what they're pushing. And this is what they have planned. And they're setting it up where getting everybody used to the checkpoints, and you get there and they say, come in an interrogation room. And then, you know, mom and the kids or whatever are sitting over there on the bench. And they're like, okay, your husband's been taken in. He's being detained. And you're being sent somewhere for observation. So get on that truck. And if you and your kids cry, they're going to taser you and beat your brains out. That's what they signed up for. And you're gone, and your husband's taken off and shot in the back of the head. Or used for medical experiments or whatever the case is. I mean, Jack Bauer gets tough on terrorists. I mean, you know. The Army tortures people's kids in front of them in Abu Ghraib. That came out in the Army report. So that's all meant to come back here. And that's what the system just can't wait to do. So they're going to take your bank account. They're going to take your farm. They're going to take everything you got. And they're going to collapse society, and they're going to implement all this unless we stop them. You see, those of you that work for the system are hearing this, and you know you're training for all this. You know that people are being hired who absolutely love to hurt innocent people, and this is what they're going to do. And the founders gave us the Second Amendment as an emergency backup to protect ourselves. Now, there are a lot of police that realize we are in a tyranny, and they're waking up. But we talk a lot about the police because you're going to be commanded by the federal brown shirts that are going to consist of a TSA stew of malcontents, perverts, and basic robbers who are pleading guilty everywhere. Some of them up stealing $1 million a year out of your bags. Yeah, we got a bunch of footage of people in wheelchairs, and they say on tape, get up. Person goes, I'm a quadriplegic. You can totally tell these people, you know, have just, you know, no muscle structure. And they're like, I can't. I don't walk. I've got tubes in my neck. And they just go, okay, we're gonna beat your bed and, you know, break all your bones. You know, when you've been paralyzed from the neck down like that, or from the chest down in the case of the video we're showing, and people throw you on the ground, in that case, that guy broke a whole bunch of bones. And it's like, hey, you can't walk? You're paralyzed? Hey, how about this? Yeah! Down with freedom! Down with honor! Down with all protections of everybody's bank accounts and everybody's future and your children. Now the Constitution is burning up in front of us, and through the holes that have been burned, just soaring all the vicious criminals and control freaks that have just wreaked havoc. Their spirit has wreaked havoc across the ages, and now they're going to get to gut America and Europe, and they're going to take everything. They're going to take all your bank accounts, and they love it if you quit your job and just shut down good, starve to death. They'll use the hordes of starving people as the excuse to take everything. It's the great reorganization, the great Soviet culling, like the Ukrainians were called, the great orgy of blood and death and murder that Lenin loved so much. His own enforcers would come back, TSA types, and say, we've held or imprisoned half the town. What? No one's resisting. Go ahead and kill the other groups. Murder. And they said, what do you want? And he said, I want more blood. 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 Okay, we've got investigative journalist and author Pat Shannan joining us here in a moment. We're going to talk about his new book that we sell, by the way, that's amazing. Everything They Ever Told Me Was a Lie, written and researched by Pat Shannan, available at InfowarsStore.com. We're going to be going over his book, but also current events with Pat Shannan. PatShannan.net is his website. Going to him in a moment, but listen. I'm not joking about the government wanting to round people up and put us in FEMA camps. It's called the Emergency Centers Establishment Act. It's called the Civilian Inmate Labor Camp Program. And it's all these different executive orders about seizure of the population into work brigades. Just type in executive orders for forced labor, and you'll be at Library of Congress. And it's been reissued by every president in the last 30 years or so, so there'll be a bunch of different ones. But go pull them up. And all over the country now, they've got federally funded checkpoints where they even face scan you with similar systems they had in Fallujah and then drag you off. And in the future, it's going to be a no buy, no fly, no gun own, no work, no travel. They've said this. You're not going to have a job. You're not going to travel. You're not going to buy food. You notice all over they're putting signs up saying we don't accept large bills now. They're trying to tell me at stores they won't take 20s now. So they're just phasing it out. They're tearing up $100 bills at Walmart that are real. They're arresting people that have $100 bills. They're arresting people that have silver and show it to someone at the park. Everything's criminal now except being criminal. Then tyranny is when criminals take over. And sure, society collapses. They don't care about that. So I want to get Pat Shannan's take on this, but here are some of these articles. Wall Street Journal reports legal families with post tax money. People have post tax money, and they are not allowed to leave with it out of the United States. They're not letting citizens leave to Costa Rica. They're not letting them leave to Switzerland. And that's in the Wall Street Journal. They say you can leave. Your money stays here. And by the way, there's not even a law. They're just saying there's no law. The UN runs our country, but Obama says they do to Congress. There's no law saying he can shut down coal power plants. They just do it. It's called government does whatever it wants. Mitt Romney hardly pays any taxes. The big mega corporations themselves on average pay zero. Most of them pay nothing. But Google pays 3.4% a year. But the average American making over $100,000 a year pays almost 40% to the Federal Reserve. Then there's the dozens of other taxes. So here's that report. And we've got a video. Truck driver stands up to unconstitutional checkpoint. Americans are reasserting their Fourth Amendment. They now have Border Patrol checkpoints 100 miles in from any border or coastline. Well, most of the population lives on coastlines. And I've seen it. They let illegal aliens just drive through unfettered, give them bank accounts. They're all left alone. Homeland Security announced months ago, we already knew, they don't take in illegal aliens now. In fact, they hire them in Homeland Security to do contracts. And people comment in this video, they go, I thought you people want to stop the illegals. The checkpoints, as Ron Paul said, are for the American people. Okay? But the really scary thing is this Lew Rockwell story. Why you need a passport now? And it goes over and has links to mainstream news where they now say they have the right, outside of law, it says there's no law, to just deny you a passport. And if you sue them, they give you a long form basically saying, who was your doctor? What was the nurse's name? And hundreds of questions no one can answer. And then they'll just say they're improper and refuse them. So this is the new system. And nothing to do with the illegals. They're just allowed in. They do a few arrests for public consumption. And again, no fly list strands man on island in Hawaii. We had him on twice last week. Hawaii is a paradise for most visitors, but it was Wade Hicks Jr.'s prison for 5 days. And he only got out because of media attention here on this show. The 34-year-old Gulfport, Mississippi, was stranded in the islands this week after being told he was on the FBI's no-fly list during a layover for a military flight from California to Japan. The episode left Hicks scrambling to figure out how he'd get home from Hawaii without being able to fly. Then he was abruptly removed from the list Thursday with no explanation. Well, we had him and another fellow on, too. This happened to a lot of people. It has raised questions on how he landed on the list. Hicks said he was traveling to visit his wife, a U.S. Navy lieutenant who deployed to Japan. He hitched a ride in a military flight and is coming for military dependents who were allowed to fly on scheduled routes when there is room. Hicks said that during the layover at the Pearl Harbor base, Immigration Customs Force an agent told him he was on a no-fly list, wouldn't be allowed to deplane. Of course, they don't want to tell you it was over the fact that he was told that he was a prepper and that they were reading. You know, they go and look up now what you do on the internet. And they got records of you flying constantly, no criminal record. They don't care. They grab your laptops now and download them. Cops all over the country now grab your cell phone and download stuff without warrants. Courts say they can. Courts say they can taser you to make you answer questions in a hospital bed. They now throw people out of wheelchairs that are quadriplegics. And the courts say, that's good. You should have minded the order. If you're having a convulsion, don't mind the order to stop having the convulsion. I'm not joking. They taser you. If the teacher uploads a picture of her breast in front of the class, they suspend the class. And they say, well, the rule says you can't see pornography. The teacher's fine. People are like, well, that makes no sense. It's meant to overturn reason. Why do they in the military give you sleep deprivation for 8 weeks and make you sing silly songs and do silly things? It's to see if you'll do what you're told. This is my rifle. This is my gun. This is for fighting. This is for fun. The Marines, at least back in the 60s, so I saw a documentary about Stanley Kubrick doing research, they made them march around grabbing their genitals. Why? Because it's you're going to do it, or I'm going to stomp your guts out. That's why. The editor of Breitbart says, I don't want to be taken behind closed doors. And they say, well, you are. And they drag her back there to grab her genitals. On video, you see the door close, and the TSA people are smiling. These are weirdos that like this. A normal person doesn't like to get in the face of somebody that deserves to be gotten in the face because it's embarrassing. It's weird when you're powerful to exercise power over people. But those that don't have power crave it. All right, continuing. It's time for us that are good to get angry and rout these people. Here's Fox News. Oh, the IRS, you're not going anywhere. We'll get Lew Rockwell on about 15 after. We're going to hold Pat over about 10 minutes. I just had to cover this because it's so important. And it says, well, they couldn't get it passed in Congress, so now they're just saying you're going to be put on a no-fly list if the IRS says, one of their bureaucrats, that they think you may not have paid everything. That means if they send you a letter saying they believe you've underpaid the private Federal Reserve, that you're not going to fly. No judge, no jury, just like Rahm Emanuel said. You are on a no-fly list that they put you on extrajudicially, over 2 million Americans on it. Senate report just came out and admitted it. Totally innocent, not one terrorist caught because they run the terrorist. That was 2 weeks ago, Senate report, confirming what we've been saying for years. Government admits they put out fake terror alerts. Governor Ridge admitted that. They're staging it all. They run Al-Qaeda overseas. And they sit there and they say, you're not going to own a gun now. We're going to not just let you buy guns now. We're going to SWAT team you in the middle of the night, even though you have no criminal record, because we put you on the list at the Threat Fusion Center. And here comes the SWAT team rolling down your door. And oopsie, they're going to gun you down in the future. And a gun gets dropped, just like the troops are trained to do in Iraq. They carry a few extra AK-47s in the tank or the APC. This is on record. And they kill 20, 30 Hajis. Just throw a gun down. What they call them. And they come back here, they become cops. And they kill their wives and kids. It's not even a big deal now. Just like, oh, yeah, that's just what happens. This is the new system. But then the rest of the veterans who held it together and were moral, well, you're all going to lose your rights too unless you join the New World Order. Then you can keep your guns. This is the hell system. And I've studied Nazi Germany, Soviet Russia, and every other tyranny. The old Roman system, when it started collapsing, wouldn't let Romans get out with their money. These are called capital controls, and they're coming. Legal. I remember talking to some members of John Wayne's family. John Wayne used to love to go camp and stay out in the county right next to Hayes County. I won't even say where. In that whole area out there. And they had some family property and some houses on some creeks. And I had a chance to talk to some of John Wayne's family, you know, direct, you know, child. And they said, this was like 4 years ago. They go, you got about 2 years to get out of the country if you've got any money. And I'm like, well, I don't really have that problem then. And they said, because they're not going to let you get out. And I said, well, how do you know that? And they said, we've been told by billionaires and others. And then I went and looked it up. Well, it's here now. You got $1 million that's yours. You aren't leaving with it. You're not going anywhere, scum. You're staying here. You understand filth? That's what they're telling you. Wall Street Journal today. You want to get out of this country where they torture and secretly arrest everybody and run Al-Qaeda? You, see, that's the thing. You're not going to run from this New World Order, ladies and gentlemen. You got to stand and fight it. But these are tyrants. Pat Shannan, we're about to go to break, but just briefly, I'll introduce you after the break. You've been talking about this forever, but what do you make of what I'm breaking down?
Well, I just called on the bank to see if I had a balance there, Alex.
No, but I mean, you've studied history. Is this not what all authoritarian regimes do?
Oh, yeah. I would hope to think that it's still some ways off, but we know the FEMA camps are going on. We know the troops are gathering around the border. So, yeah, who's to say you're wrong? I mean, we just can't know how imminent it is.
Well, I don't think it's going to even be imminent. It's just going to be slow motion. Where'd Bob go? Oh, he got taken away for questioning terrorists. And you better not question or you're going to be a terrorist. They're already getting it where they're saying we're not going to work or have a job unless they say it's okay.
Yeah, well, you can't even, almost anything is an excuse to put one in jail today. Almost any minor offense. And that's not even an offense in many cases. And, of course, the FBI is great at creating crimes. We just saw another one last week in New York at the Fed building.
Let's talk about that when we come back. Pat Shannan is an investigative journalist covering false flag events ranging from assassination of Lincoln to events of September 11th. He's the author of several books. The newest, available at Infowars.com. Everything they ever told me was a lie. By the way, the money bomb, huge success. We're going to be able to get the satellite uplinks and file sharing software. You're going to start seeing the show pop up on more and more cable and TV systems worldwide. Thanks to everybody supporting us. We raised right up close to $500,000, which is the most we've ever raised. Thank you so much. God bless you, Info Warriors. The once-a-year event's been a big success. We have a diabolical government. Pat Shannan, you've been fighting the globalists for, I don't know, more than two decades. I remember when I was first getting woken up, I was reading stuff you were writing in Media Bypass and other places. But now so much of it's come true. You know, back then they said it was a terrorism, basically, if you said there was a world government that was going to be set up by banks. Now it's like you're a terrorist if you don't love the world government being set up by banks. Pat Shannan, on your radar screen, what is front and center? There's so much to talk about. I mean, I guess the Federal Reserve, they're victims now. I predicted they would foil false flags against it. And as usual, it's coming out that it's Patsyville.
Well, yeah, well, the incident last week was so obvious, and especially when the FBI has such a reputation for this. You know, in fact, it was one of their federal government antics that brought you and me together the first time with the Oklahoma City bombing back in 95.
That's right.
But what happened last week, Judge Napolitano, I don't know if you caught it, but he said that's the 18th time, the 18th time since 2001, 911, that this has happened. And now those are just the ones that were exposed, my friend.
I mean, you know they're staging stuff when even the New York Times and Washington Post admit it. Break down how they set up these useful idiots.
Well, I think mentioning the New York Times back in 93, I think it's October 27th or 8th issue, they actually tell the whole story about the alleged terrorist, Salem was his last name, spelled like Salem, and how he actually stung the FBI when he offered to bring them some white powder that was, you know, subtle, non-explosive. And they said they insisted, and he taped them on the telephone. They insisted that, no, he used the real explosives. So he did a reverse sting on the FBI, and it really was laughable to those of us who were tuned in.
Yeah, he was the handler of the low-grade morons they chose. They made him cook the bomb, train the driver, use real detonators. He figured out, because he'd worked for the CIA, that they were setting him up, so he recorded them. And then did a press conference the day after the attack saying, look, I'm not involved. So instead of them being able to set him up as the mastermind, they had to pay him off.
Correct. And with egg all over their faces.
But they just do it over and over again. It turns out they got this guy into the country again and insisted he get a visa. But meanwhile, if you're a constitutionalist, they're putting you on a no-fly list.
Yeah, that is... It's so much powerful control over we the people. And I've said it for a long time. It's a long chapter. The first chapter in my book, it's going to be the first chapter in volume two as well, and that's what's hiding in plain sight is the power of legal tender. Once they stole the lawful money from us, the circulating gold and silver coin, and began to counterfeit not only paper, but the slug coins since 1965, then they can do anything. As you well know, Rothschild said, give me the control of a nation's money supply, and I don't care who makes its laws.
You're right. This is a short segment. A long segment's coming up. I don't do pre-interviews normally. Pat, there's so much to talk about. What do you want to get to when we come back? I mean, there's just so much.
Well, the assassinations and the news media cover-up section, large section of my book, is I covered very, very well-known cases, you know, the attempt on Reagan, JFK. But what I've done here in everything they ever told me was a lie was point out the fallacies in the government's official stories, but also little details that are major details that were never reported. And everyone who reads my book says, holy smokes, I didn't know that was going on in that case. And so I'll point out some of them to you in the next segment.
We'll do that. What do you make of Building 7 on 9/11 where there's video where they say, get back, we're blowing it up, and the news goes, the building is falling on its own footprint. Oh, it's still up there. It's coming down in a minute. I mean, it's just so obvious.
That was the BBC lady, yeah. Now, once again, egg all over their faces. I believe, as so many rumors are circulating, but the only one that makes sense to me, you know, without proof, I believe that was the brains operation in Giuliani's office and the whole CIA equipment, and I think that's why they had to bring it down.
Well, I want to ask the CIA and FBI and all these guys something. I mean, you guys know the government's bringing in the drugs. You guys know the government's behind white slavery, little kids. Do you really want to be signed on to this? I mean, come on. It's out in the open now. The government's evil. And you're destroying your own future. I mean, I just don't get it. I mean, the type of tyranny they're bringing in, Pat Shannan, is so hot. This is not just some corruption they're going to get away with. This thing is all or nothing.
Once again, the power of legal tender. You see, those guys have got six-figure incomes now, Alex, plus great retirements. That's an easy way to sway a guy to not so much come out and blatantly lie, but just tell little white lies and ignore the real facts.
So they got the guys wearing white hats that just go along with the evil, with brigades of black hat operatives within every agency.
Yeah, and you know what? The right hand doesn't know what the left hand's doing. I discovered that in Oklahoma City bombing.
Yeah, stay there. Exactly. That's why we found out the feds did it. We'll be right back. I'm your host, Alex Jones. It is Monday, the 22nd day of October, 2012. I know we have a lot of fans out there of Pat Shannan. We'll take a few calls before he leaves us. The toll-free number to join us on air on any issue you'd like to raise with Pat Shannan, our guest, is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. PatShannan.net is his website. We're going back to him in a moment, getting into some of the areas that his book, Everything They Ever Told Me Was a Lie, breaks down. It's an excellent book. Very easy read, but also thick. Lots of chapters, lots of documents, lots of photos. This is great to give somebody who is somewhat awake, but not all the way awake, or somebody who's totally asleep. This will blow their mind. Again, I just keep thanking everybody. Amazing job to all the listeners. This was the fifth annual pledge drive. We've always done one day out of the year in the last 5 years. We've never raised more than $500,000, and it's a lot of small donations. We want to thank everybody. I went to Barton Springs to swim some laps Saturday after the 48-hour broadcast because I had such a headache. I thought that would get rid of my headache, and by the way, it did. And I ran to one of the lifeguards who bought a ProPure water filter discounted at InfowarsStore.com as part of the money bomb. And it just was humbling to, you know, actually run into somebody who donated. Plus, they got a great water filter at discounted prices. Win-win. So if you go to InfowarsMoneyBomb.com, you can see some of the top featured interviews we did with so many amazing people like Gerald Celente and George Norrie and many, many others. Joel Skousen, David Icke. It is all up there, Max Kaiser at InfowarsMoneyBomb.com. We also, it was 48 hours. We ended up going about 46 hours. James Wesley Rawls, very powerful interview we did as well. And then there's a link to all the interviews, 40-plus hours of them, up there at Infowars.com. You can link through to our official YouTube channel. And it's all archived in higher res quality at PrisonPlanet.tv. So again, this is in Let Us Get the Uplinks. Now I'm just going to decide which ones to get to hit different parts of the world, to budget that out, the different file sharing systems to get on local TV stations around the country, because most TV picks you up off of these big file sharing systems that are very expensive to subscribe to. So, I mean, it is a lost leader to get the word out, but it will expand the audience so we can have a few sponsors. And we're kind of a hybrid for TV where we don't have, you know, zero ads, but we have, you know, some ads. And so I'm having to codify all that after a few years beta testing it. We are just rushing forward. 5 years ago, we would reach about 3 million people a week. Now it's 15 million a week. Just amazing. So, again, all of you, great job. You're not behind us. You're right beside us in this fight. And 100% of the money from the money bomb will go towards the infrastructure and equipment and the satellite uplinks. So, again, thank you so much. And you've seen the expansion we've done with the last four. It's just given us that extra, you know, money to really, well, plant seeds. Preachers call it seed money. Well, that's what it is. Okay, let's go ahead and go back to Pat Shannan. Pat, again, you've got the floor. Take it away with this page-turner book, Everything They Ever Told Me Was a Lie. Let's just run through some of it. Reagan's an interesting one, but you're also talking about the money power. Go ahead.
Before I do, let me say to your audience that I recently uncovered your interview of maybe 4 or 5 years ago, that 90-minute interview with Aaron Russo. And speaking of people who are half asleep or half awake, that is about the greatest thing anyone could ever look at. I want to commend you. And Aaron and I were friends. I shot pool with him and his boys in his basement in his Beverly Hills home back in the 80s. He and I went way back. But that guy, I watched him grow. I watched him grow in truth. And I just want to tell your audience to tune in. It costs them nothing. Just pull it up on Prison Planet TV and have a look at it. It's dynamite.
Yeah, it's up there in high res on prisonplanet.tv. But it's called Reflection Warnings. It's almost 2 hours long. And I went down there, and his wife was really sweet because he could barely walk at the time and was in excruciating pain and had been fighting cancer for like 4 years at the time. He ended up living another year, or not quite a year. And, I mean, that guy was just unbelievably tough. I don't want to get into all of it. But he sat there, you know, at the table for 2 hours being interviewed by me and was just, you know, in excruciating pain the whole time. And the point is, he was a great guy. And I think that's why that interview is so good. And there's a little clip at the restaurant. I'll never forget the last time I saw him personally. You know, we went to a restaurant and he got out. The car pulled up. He got in it and he gave me a hug. And I could tell by the way he was acting, he knew he was going to be going over the mountain. Absolutely, pretty powerful. In fact, speak some more about Aaron Russo if you'd like.
Well, Aaron and I first met back in the late 80s when Tupper Saucy was on the lam and traveling under a false name, and I was his Tupper's window to society back then. And ended up going to dinner with this man. I didn't know anything about Aaron's reputation and movie making, and I learned all about it that evening. Also, a little known fact is that he was longtime live-in with a movie star that everyone would know, and I probably shouldn't mention this on the tube, but most people, if they knew Aaron's history at all, would know whom I'm talking about.
It's not a secret. Bette Midler. On top of that, he was also the guy that originally got Led Zeppelin over here. So, yeah. Yep.
Well, what I was going to tell was a secret, but now I can't. But anyhow, he took Bette to Hollywood, and they later split up for some
No,
reason.
I don't think that's a secret, bro. I think that was even like in his obituary. I mean, I guess it wasn't widely known, but the internet now, everything's widely known. No, I mean, he produced the big play that got her into stuff. Yeah. He also invented a lot of other stuff. Very interesting fellow. Certainly an evil person that built it. What did you make of Obama saying you didn't build that and talking down entrepreneurs? That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, the best retort, and I'm not fond of any of these candidates this season, never am, but if you haven't seen the talk that Mitt Romney did last Thursday night at that Al Smith dinner, you must pull it up. It's one of the best political speeches, comedy things. I mean, he has some terrific comedy writers, and if you haven't seen that speech, you gotta pull it up and listen to it. It's dynamite. It's a rib rocker. You asked me about the book, and we're talking about the FBI and all. And more over the years, I've grown to see how my suspicions and yours and many others in the past have come to be true with the way that the government frames people, even, you know, goes right into the courts. And FBI agents lying under oath, I saw, covering so many federal trials over the years, I saw that over and over. But, you know, proving it is something else, and very few people would have the facts of not being an investigative reporter.
Oh, it's now been proven in this case out of Round Rock in Georgetown, where they where the kids said, hey, daddy wasn't home, another man killed mommy, and they had the DNA and, you know, evidence and all sorts of stuff, and knowingly sent the guy to prison for fun. And you read about stuff like that, it'd be one thing to set up a five-time ex-con or something. That'd be immoral and wrong. But when they send innocent family men, business owners with no criminal record to jail and know they're innocent, I mean, it's just it's downright evil.
It is. And I, in the section on who killed Robert Kennedy, in my book, I point that out, that Herbert McDonald was a director of a laboratory of forensic science. And he was quoted saying that the revolver taken from Sirhan, considering all the physical factors, could not have been the one that fired the projectile removed from Bobby Kennedy. Well, we come on down to the trial, Alex, and here they have their high-ranking criminologist. This is, by the way, on page 224, sits on the witness stand and under oath says that the serial number of the .22 revolver that killed Kennedy was H18602. And yet the recorded number of the weapon carried by Sirhan was H53725. And I asked four separate criminal attorneys, defense attorneys, I said, is there any way that could have gotten by a defense counsel? He said, no way. All of them said to a degree, no way. We would have had the numbers in front of us on the table, and it was just a phony charade. And so what I'm saying, Alex, is this high-powered attorney, Grant Cooper in California at the time, had to have been paid off to lose the case. And even Sirhan tried to fire him, and then the judge wouldn't let him. So the whole thing was controlled from the beginning.
You're right. And that case I mentioned earlier was the Michael Morton case, where, again, they were just all in on sending the innocent guy to jail, and over the decades knew it, and just reportedly didn't even care. Former prosecutor Ken Anderson faces charges. That's now coming out. And it's just so, well, Williamson County, north of us, is really a wicked place, because you got all these Bible Belt folks that are real naive, and you've got a really sinister, one of the most sinister group of police forces up there and prosecutors I've ever seen. You know, it's strange how one county cannot be corrupt and the next county can be corrupt. It just seems like the more naive the population, a lot of times the more Bible Belty they are, for a strange reason, the more evil it can get, because people are so naive. Have you seen that?
Yeah. And trusting of government. Monroe County, Tennessee, it's going on right now. You may remember reading over the past couple of years, I did a few articles on Lieutenant Commander Walt Fitzpatrick, who tried to go after Obama on the phony birth thing like 3 years ago. One thing led to another. He discovered all kinds of grand jury discrepancies. The foreman of the grand jury had been sitting there for over 20 years, and yet the Tennessee law says they can't sit more than 1 year. The people that have gone down, like in that case in Monroe County, Darren Huff has gone to federal prison for 4 years for a crime that never even happened. And I covered that trial up in Knoxville. It's just one more false prosecution, because they were able to nail him on a gun charge that was made up. And here he was licensed, but it goes on.
Well, that's
on
like the Davidians. They were found not guilty of murder, but found guilty using guns in the commission of murder. And even when the Supreme Court, after they've been in jail, what, like 7 years, because I went and covered it, said release them, the federal prison didn't. I mean, it's just lawlessness. And the more innocent you are, the more they want to throw you in prison. And you know, that's coming out with the DNA and all this. It's really weird.
Yeah, well, Leonard Peltier, you know, that goes back to the Wounded Knee you mentioned earlier. Those two FBI agents who died, there was never any proof that Leonard did it. He was a convenient patsy.
Amazing. They just grab whoever they want, I guess, to get a collar or whatever.
Yeah. I'm working on this, still working on this West Memphis story of Jerry and Joe Kane. That begins to stink more and more with the situation where I have a copy of the autopsies. And these guys were shot with automatic weapons, Alex.
Well, break down that story for those that may not know. Recap that.
Well, they were traveling from Las Vegas back home to Florida on I-40 coming in to West Memphis from Little Rock. And the official story says that they were pulled off in a traffic stop. And the son, Joe Kane, was 16 and Jerry was 46 or so.
And explain who they were and why this is important.
Well, they were exposing the money situation, and they were doing seminars around the country on the fraud in the Fed, and that's hallowed ground that you and I must not step on, yet we do it all the time. And So Jerry Kane, the father, was driving and allegedly was pulled over on a traffic stop. However, when the son jumps out and they show a video, but not till 48 days later, of the son doing shooting and killing his cops, he's got AR-15 or AK-47, but it's semi-automatic. And so that's my point here. And then I'm imagining if you had killed a couple of cops, would you hang around a town like West Memphis, Arkansas for the next 90 minutes? I wouldn't. And yet, one exit down, 90 minutes later, Jerry and Joe Kane were surrounded and shot up and killed in a Walmart parking lot. Only one exit from this other one where the cops were killed. Anyway, it's far too difficult and complex to go in on this short time we have left. But what it boils down to is those men were killed with automatic weapons. And I don't know who did it, but I the angle, the ballistics, everything showed it could not have been Joe Kane from the video that they trumped up and showed us some 48 days later. So, but once again, these are the sorts of things. That story, by the way, will be in volume two of everything they're filming was a lie.
Let's look at Oklahoma City. They're now talking about domestic groups are going to strike. Homeland Security's not for Al-Qaeda. It's for the American people. We knew that was always where this was headed. I mean, Oklahoma City, I mean, in the 2 minutes we've got before we go to break, what do listeners need to know about that event?
Well, most people don't remember the basics because, once again, we're talking about 17 years ago. But the basics were, as General Parton, and I always said, if the FBI and the courts really wanted the truth on what had happened at Oklahoma City with the blast, and they would have called General Parton to the stand, who showed that the charges were inside the building. He showed which columns they were at, and he first spotted this sitting in his home in Virginia, looking at nothing more than Time and Newsweek magazines, looking at the pictures, and he tells his wife, "Baloney, this no truck bomb did this." And so General Parton came to Oklahoma, and we met him, and he began to look at the fire department's hundreds of other pictures and found at least four spots where the charges were set inside the building and strategically right above the nursery. That's the way it was designed to murder children. And because they found out that what they had pulled in New York back in 1793 just did not seem to strum the heartstrings of America the way they wanted to. So they had to kill some innocent children. And this is the hardest thing, as you mentioned, for Christian America to understand and believe that what these dogs will stoop to.
But we know the government admits to tens of thousands of people exposed to sarin, nerve gas, radiation, you name it. And they admit to, in the Department of Energy, killing thousands of foster children in radiation experiments and shooting black men up with syphilis. I mean, everybody knows about that stuff. So, what, you'll fry little kids to death, but you won't blow them up at the Alfred P. Murrah building to get control? I mean, it's a no-brainer.
That's right. It's very obvious. So, anyway, the Oklahoma City thing was an atrocity. I've spent more time out there, as much as any reporter, I guess, on the case. And, interviewed people who were actual victims, as well as investigators. Hoppy Heidelberg became one of my closest friends over the last decade.
He just died this year. So did Russell Means. Mm-hmm. We're going to come right back with Pat Shannan and your phone calls. Everything they ever told me was a lie. Then we're going to ask Pat where he sees America going. Are we waking people up, or are we starting to win, or are we just waking up to the fact we're total slaves run by psycho killers? And, how bad will it get? I mean, I guess the sky's the limit. I'm Alex Jones. Stay with us. We're going to take some calls right now for Pat Shannan. And then we've got Lew Rockwell coming up of lewrockwell.com. I'm Alex Jones with Infowars.com. The new book is Everything They Ever Told Him Was a Lie. And, here's the problem. When we just get to the point now where, okay, the government's corrupt, they can do whatever they want. And then everyone's intimidated by government. And government is now in a stance of, we're intimidating you. Society starts to collapse. I want to go to some phone calls for Pat Shannan. But, Pat, do you think things are getting better wake-up-wise? Are they getting worse? Where do you see things going?
Well, I've uncovered a quote since I finished that book that I'm going to use in the opening of my prologue of the new one. And this is from William Casey. You remember William Casey from the Reagan administration?
CIA director.
Correct. He was Reagan's first. And this is quoted from CIA Director William Casey's first staff meeting in 1981, where he said, "We'll know Our disinformation program is complete when everything the American public believes is false. Now, so to answer your question, when there's their whole goal the last 30 years laid out, and I think they're succeeding, and we seem to have arrived, Alex. The world's upside down. I mean, look at the...
Well, and they say we've got to take your rights because of Al-Qaeda, while they publicly fund Al-Qaeda overseas. And they have crazy weirdos who take an eight-hour class, who grab our wives and drag them away to private rape rooms. And the Army new manual says re-education camps. They don't even use a term like, you know, centers to inform and change radicalization or something. No, it's like, we're going to put you in a re-education camp. I mean, it's just like, man, you really are criminals. I mean, it's scary.
Yeah, the lobbyists that have, you know, are the foreign interlopers in destroying our republic. Look at the AMA doctors and Medicare and Big Pharma. They've destroyed medicine.
Look at the UN is going to be here overseeing the election, but not the electronic voting machines. They're going to be there to make sure there can be low-level election fraud and you know, retail vote stealing.
Yeah, I've been screaming about electronic vote fraud since 07. And still, most people on the street don't even know what goes on. Well, you and I watched what happened in the primaries, how they shut out Ron Paul with the electronic vote. Here he's drawing thousands to where Romney's drawing hundreds in his crowds, and we don't even know it.
Unbelievable. Pat Shannon's our guest. Chris in Kentucky, you're on the air with Pat Shannan.
Yes, Alex, thanks for taking my call. Just on the Oklahoma City issue, I'm going to get the Noble Lie DVD for those who don't know about Oklahoma City or are not old enough. It's very important to see that because I didn't realize.
You've been calling for like 10 years. You haven't gotten through in a long time.
No, I haven't. This is the first time I've gotten through since a long time. Yeah, I've been working a lot, slaving for the New World Order. What do you expect?
Well, you better not try to take your after-tax money to Switzerland or anywhere else. This isn't America, boy.
No, it's freedom. It's great for America to be this way. It's just fantastic. Oh, by the way, here we had a news item here. They're going to get these new federally funded patrol boats on the Ohio River for the next events of the Kentucky
Derby. Oh, yeah. They're even going to put them in lakes now with machine guns, just big armored patrol boats harassing you and your family. And you know somebody isn't going to comply. They're going to have to open up with them and kill the whole family, but that's good. Again, they got to teach us they're the military, we're the enemy. Military kills people, breaks things. We're now occupied, we're the enemy, they're the big men. Argh.
Exactly, and the TSA machines may go into the Kentucky Derby, Churchill Downs. Well, that's coming. I know it's coming. All this security, improved security, they talk about it year after year. This is what it is. This is what's coming down.
Well, I've seen the Army with sidearms running around arresting people at Kentucky Derby. But that, I mean, North Korea's got troops on the streets. I mean, North Korea is the example of freedom. And if you're not for North Korea, you're not pro-America. But we should replace our flag, Pat Shannan, with the North Korean flag. What do you think?
Well, I figure they're flying the flag of the insurrectionists anyway. I live in the deep south, brother.
You're so evil. We'll be right back with more calls. Shannon's our guest. We need to get him on more often. Lew Rockwell coming up. Let's continue with calls here. Bill in California, you're on the air with Pat Shannan. Go ahead.
Alex, God bless you.
God bless you, sir. What's on your mind?
Hey, Pat. You remember Don Harkin?
Don Harkin, yeah. I do. I remember the name. Where is he from, California?
No, he's up in Idaho with the Idaho Observer with Ingram, remember?
Sure. Of course, yeah. No, I'm sorry. I was thinking of Don someone else, but of course. Yes, Don and Ingram, I knew them both, and I spent some time up there with the family and even actually visited his gravesite.
Right, and I called up there that day, and Ingram was telling you about a guy that did something like, "How y'all doing, Pat? Remember me?"
Jack McGlam.
No, Bill Clinton.
He's doing a Bill Clinton imitation.
Well, I know. Hillary and I, Alex, are doing everything we can to abort this new concept. But anyway, setting that aside, you asked for my email, but I couldn't get back. I had a lot of disabled vet problems medically, but I'll get back to you. I wanted to ask you, what's your opinion on the October surprise? Do you think they're going to pull anything with troops or the gangs like they've been training for 30 years?
I'm thinking they may have already pulled it. I'm reading some interesting stuff, and it's about the only scenario that makes sense to me is what happened in Libya was actually a kidnapping planned by Obama and that went bad. And if this is true, then that might have well been his October surprise.
Well, you know, there's so many angles, yeah. And that's one of them I've looked at is kidnap the guy. Al-Qaeda's who they put in, it worked. People ended up fighting back too much. They get killed. So that's why they were dragging him around. And then they were going to have like a hostage crisis like in 1979, 1980. But then Obama would have had them give him back. He could say, see, I did a good job.
Yeah, I'd have been the hero.
What about all this talk there could be riots if Obama doesn't win?
Well, I think that they would be quelled quickly in that the most of those doing that would, of course, would be the black regiments around the country. And they just don't have the firepower, I think, to go very far with very many riots. Oh, sure, we would see some buildings burned down, but I don't think there would be a mass war.
Let's go ahead and take another call from Vince in California. Go ahead, Vince.
Hey, good morning, you guys. Alex, love your show. I've been listening for 5 years. And Pat, I've been reading your stuff for longer than that. Love you guys.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, I got two quick points that kind of tie together. One, Alex, you've had Al Adask on your show many times, and he's got a colleague named Roger Sales, S-A-Y-L-E-S, who talks about the way the feds get us under their jurisdiction is we volunteer for it by saying we're United States citizens.
And you don't have to be. Listen, I know about all that stuff. Here's the deal. The globalists do whatever they want. They're lawless criminals. It's true when you contract with them, it ropes you more and more in. It's good to get out of the system as much as you can. But I'm telling you, they don't even follow the Bill of Rights and Constitution. They have the NSA illegally spying on us. And so all this patriot mythology stuff, and I'm not saying he's doing that, but so much of it leads to a dead end. That's why I don't promote it. Let me get a quick take here from Pat Shannan on that.
Oh, I have to agree. Regardless of how many of these things are lawfully correct, when you're up against a tyrannical government, it makes no difference.
Yeah, I mean, that's the deal, folks. They go and for a year and a half try to get Amish to sell the neighbor milk, and they do an undercover sting to act like it's illegal when it's not even illegal to trick the jury into convicting him for another statute. And the feds knew it wasn't illegal. I mean, these are people that love to hurt good people. Pat Shannan, great having you with us. The book, Everything They Ever Told Me Was a Lie. It's available at InfoWarsStore.com. That supports Pat and us and everybody else. It's a great book. Pat, we'll talk soon.
Thank you.
Thank you, buddy.
I always enjoy being with you.
We're going to have you back. We'll get into actual assassinations and stuff. All right, coming up, ton of news, your calls. Okay, Lew Rockwell is coming up to give us his take on the election, the police state, and so much more. Former Chief of Staff Ron Paul. All the big UK papers are reporting hundreds of Savelle's pedophile pals are hunted. That's out of the Sun. Victims of Twisted Jimmy Savelle are believed to have told police that more than 100 other pedophiles were involved in the attacks. This is just like Penn State, folks. He was just a procurer. This is a guy that hangs out with the royal family. Cops investigating the disgraced BBC DJ and TV presenter have understood to have been given names and descriptions of the men. Last night, a source told The Sun the scale of what has gone on is unbelievable. It must be more likely that among these names will be some very well-known people indeed. This is all coming out now because England's, they're trying to bring it into the Euro, so they're getting ready to blow out all their networks. More than 200 people now say they were molested by Savelle and his cronies. Met Commander Peter Spindler, heading an investigation, which is more than 400 separate lines of inquiry, said the public's response has been astounding. Last night he said, we don't want to get into numbers game, but the vast majority of the allegations, we had a reporter on last week about this, so he said it'd be huge, related to Savelle and a bunch of other big, high-powered people. Rumors about Jimmy Savelle circulated among broadcasters for years. Yeah, we had a BBC broadcaster on talk about it, heard about it in the 90s, but were thought too dark to be true. TV's Amanon Holmes said yesterday, he said that one even suggested Savelle was necrophilic. Yeah, that's what came out. He added, that was so ridiculously outrageous, you could never believe it. The father of four added, you could look at Jimmy Savelle as eccentric. You could look upon him as something out of a horror movie. Tycoon William Goad, 65, feared to abuse 3,500 boys to abuse them, died of natural causes in a Albany jail on the Isle of Wight yesterday. And folks, if you look at photos of Jimmy Savile, he looks just like, just as demonic and textbook crazy pervert type as Sandusky looked. I mean, and again, it's networks of these people that use government and use media as their power networks. And it shows how power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Okay, now, continuing here, ladies and gentlemen, with some of the economic news, then we're going to go to our guest. Greece austerity diet risked 1930-style depression, and that's out of Bloomberg. But we had the former World Bank chief economist Joseph Stiglitz say last week it's already a depression, but our media says it's not. Continuing with other economic news, Obamacare mandate. Anyone who works 30 hours a week is now full-time, and you've got to supposedly get them health care, so everybody then goes to 20 hours, or you just lay people off. Merkel to warn UK on Europe budget veto. Chinese gold imports through August surpassed total ECB holdings, European Central Bank holdings. Imports from Australia surged 900%. Governments, George Soros, you name it, they're all buying gold. So that's just some of the economic news. We have the presidential debate on foreign policy coming up tonight. And there's very little difference between these two and who their advisors are. So we're going to be getting into more of that. But don't worry. In most polls, Mitt Romney has pulled ahead, but there's electronic voting fraud. But even if he ended up getting in, he's, again, controlled by the very same crony capitalist apparatus. And, of course, the Hill also reports the UN to monitor U.S. elections, but not for electronic voting fraud, the big kahuna, but for retail-type stuff. If people try to stop the grassroots fraud, of course, Lew Rockwell, head of the Von Mises Institute, and he is also a former chief of staff for Ron Paul, lewrockwell.com, syndicated columnist. He can speak to all of these things. I want to cover a laundry list with Lew Rockwell, who was kind enough to come on with today. Lew, much going on. I mean, obviously, you're not a fan of Romney or Obama, but do you have any views on how either one of these guys and the power structures behind them, I mean, really different arms of the same ogre, but I mean, I understand you've divorced yourself from this corrupt system, never been part of it, but I mean, if you had to take one of these poisons, would you have a flavor that would be less nauseous?
No, I don't think so, Alex. I mean, it seems to me that, for example, Romney is just slightly more of a warmonger than Obama. Now, it's difficult to be more of a warmonger than Obama, but I think he's slightly more likely to nuke Iran, which is what some people want him to do, and commit other kinds of war crimes. On the other hand, of course, Obama has not ended the war in Iraq. It's still going on with a vast number of U.S. mercenaries there and still troops and, of course, all these vast occupation embassies and consulates all over the country full of spies and troops. That's still going on. Of course, the Afghanistan war was going on. Obama bombed Libya. He's bringing about the destruction of Syria. That's all a U.S., Turkey, Israeli, British, French operation in Syria. This didn't just happen. But I think Romney is likely to be worse. Is Obama slightly worse on economics? I don't know. I mean, the government grows just as fast under the Republicans as it does under the Democrats, maybe faster sometimes under the Republicans as under George W. Bush. Of course, Obama's worse than Bush. Will Obama II be worse than Obama I? Will Romney be worse than Obama I? I would say yes. So, you can't, all you can do when you're faced with the choice of these two evils is just, don't participate. Don't take either flavor of the poison, abstain from the poison, don't vote, and then you have no responsibility for what these creeps are going to do to us.
So I get your point. Buying into the whole two-party, one-body dictatorship almost lends credibility to it. But I do think locally, where you have 8% turnout nationwide, people should go get in to sabotage the bureaucrats, to expose corruption, to kind of do what Ron Paul has done and act as a watchdog.
Well, I think Ron Paul, of course, is an exception. I mean, here's a man who, and I'll tell you why he's an exception. Not only does he have the right principles, which, of course, is essential, but he's not power mad. He's not power hungry. He doesn't actually want to run anybody else's life. So that sets him apart from all these creeps in Washington, all the creeps who want to go to Washington, presidents and all the, and all, you know, and town councilmen and mayors, too. They're all like this. They all want to run other people's lives. So if we, so that, you know, Ron Paul's different. Whether, you know, voting, I mean, as you know, I'm a skeptic about voting. Unless the election's decided by one vote, your vote doesn't count. Now, so why to go to the trouble, go to some horrible socialist public school or some commie church or whatever they hold these voting, you know, the voting machines at? And as you say, you can't believe the results anyway. We know there's electronic hacking. We know that there's old-fashioned vote stealing. You know, didn't start or end with Mayor Daley. I mean, this is the normal thing in American politics, as it is every place.
Well, Lew Rockwell, so, let me bring this up to
don't
you.
Don't do it.
This is the important question I have in this area for you. Undoubtedly, there are cycles in history, and we are entering a very, very decadent cycle. Disagree with me if you don't think that's the case. And I am now seeing things that even I can't believe. I mean, we get new footage every few days of police telling quadriplegics to walk and then beating them when they don't. And then the police department says, well, you should have followed the order. Or we see a teacher uploads pictures of her breasts to the class computer. The kids get expelled. We see the TSA now at highway checkpoints groping people. We see an article at lewrockwell.com right here. Why you need a passport now, saying they'll just deny anybody a passport they want for no reason. And then that dovetails with Wall Street Journal admitting there's not even a law, but they're not letting Americans who have after-tax money and can prove it to leave with any money. Again, I was told that by some very wealthy people a few years ago that they had to get out now. That was coming. Here's the Associated Press. A guy was a prepper. They looked at his website. He was flying out of Hawaii to see his wife in Japan. They wouldn't let him fly. No judge, no jury. They've said they're going to put you on a no-gun buy list, too. That's AP. We have, you know, all of these reports where the IRS wanted a law this year where if they say you haven't paid taxes, no judge, no jury, then you can't leave the country, or they say you can't come back in, and now they're just saying they're going to do it as a bureaucracy through Homeland Security without a law. That's Fox News. Senators say if you leave the country with money, even legally, you can't come back. That's ABC News. So I'm showing these. Is this not the ultimate sign of an authoritarian takeover when, in every case in history, they put capital controls on? I mean, this is the final cherry on top.
Alex, you know, you've been fighting this stuff for years. I have too. The speed of it is I must say, slightly astounding, as you're pointing out. But yeah, they do the capital controls. They want to prevent you from taking your money out of the country. And this is your own earnestly owned money or earned money, money you've paid taxes on, you've been already looted on. And, you know, it began when you could no longer take money of more than $10,000 with you out of the country on an airplane. That was some years ago. And, you know, they want to crack down. Now they're confiscating people's money with less than $10,000 if they have it on their person.
That's what the TSA is. They're even taking $1,000. They're even taking 5 or 6 silver coins, and they put it on the news. Today, $2,000 was found, and the guy apologizes, and they take it.
That's right. And then you have to appeal to get it back, and good luck to you. Because, of course, the government takes this sort of thing. It's the local police as well.
These are crazy robbers. We've now arrived at total tyranny, except for shutting down the media, and now they're talking about that.
Well, as Murray Rothbard said, you always think about the government as a gang of thieves writ large. And if you think about the government that way, then actually none of this stuff surprises you. What's happened, I mean, every government sort of has the ambition to be a totalitarian state. They'd all like to be Nazis or communists if they could get away with it. But public pressure prevents them from doing so. But ever since 9/11 and this whole unlimited forever war on terror where there's an incorporeal enemy, I mean, the enemy doesn't even, is an idea, giving them, you know, permanent authority to run our lives, control us, take our money, feel us up, do everything they want to us. Once that's arrived, yes, you're right. We're already an authoritarian state. We're headed towards a totalitarian state.
Isn't this really a will to power? Because we've had corrupt elites before, but they like due process to protect themselves. Hollywood's selling all these anti-liberty, anti-family messages, anti-God. The police are held up if they're more brutal. I mean, doesn't the power structure realize that they're building a system that will end up being used against them? I mean, it seems like a will to power madness, an orgy of control freak nobodies going towards this bloodbath.
Alex, you're exactly right. It's like the ancient fable of the scorpion and the frog. You know, the scorpion encourages the frog to take him across the stream, and the frog's afraid he's going to hurt him. He says, no, I won't hurt you. After all, it would hurt me, too. So they get out in the middle of the stream. The scorpion stings the frog, and he's drowning, and they're both going to drown. He says, why did you do it? And he says, well, it's my nature. Well, it's the nature of the people who go into politics, who are members of the power elite, who want nothing more than to rule other people. They're concerned. What they want is power. They can get money. They can get other things when they have the power. They want the power. They're desperate for the power. They're demonic. I mean, they're criminals, and they feel that they've got right now. They feel they're making this move. It's not only, of course, in the United States and in Europe. It's all over the world where these people are making a move for a world totalitarian state, and. You know, it's happening right before our eyes, and as you say, the news is quite extraordinary. But I think also more and more people are waking up. You're helping wake up people. More and more people are waking up. So it's the constant struggle that's always existed throughout all of human history between power and market, between liberty and government. So sometimes the government gets ahead, and they have what they wanted in ancient Egypt, where the pharaoh, the government was actually God, which is what they really would like. They would actually like us to worship them as gods. So, but sometimes liberty gets ahead too. So this is a constant battle going back and forth. Right now, there's no question, power has been in the ascendancy like I haven't seen it on a worldwide basis, certainly in my lifetime. But the people are fighting back. More and more people are learning. That's the key. You have to learn about what's going on. You can't just turn your head. You can't ignore it. You can't avert your eyes. That's giving power to all the evil forces in the world. So we have to be involved. First of all, we have to learn what's going on. That's why your program is so valuable, of course.
There are a lot of people out there that do feel helpless, but you talk about market power, which is really the individual voting with one of the few things we've got left to vote with. That's why the system craves these controlled markets. Michelle Obama telling us what we can eat. 15 years ago, 20 years ago, you couldn't find organic food on store shelves. People were willing to pay for it, so it created a market. Now they're trying to come in with fraudulent organic, but that's going to happen. Slavery in 1860, most people were either for it or tacitly supported it. 65 years later, it was outlawed, or 67 years later, it was outlawed. Marijuana laws, 30, 40 years ago, they'd give you life in prison in places like Texas if you had one marijuana cigarette. Now the police themselves know it's a fraud, so they catch somebody with it, they just let them go because they know it's a joke. There's so many hundreds of examples of where people just stop complying and get it and understand that what's going on is wrong, and that self-preservation for everybody means that we all start, even people in the system, just dragging our feet, not going along with it, saying no to the TSA, saying no to new taxes, saying no to new bureaucracies, getting in the face of the nanny state. I mean, what can you say about voting with our dollars and the power people have if they will simply vote with their dollars, and some examples of that?
Well, also, we should vote with our literal dollars. We should always, to the extent we can, always use cash. Get cash out of the bank, and that hurts the banks, by the way. Get your cash out of the banks and spend it. They hate it. But it's something that it harms the whole banking Federal Reserve.
Oh, I've tried to
system.
Get $1,000 out and act like I'm a criminal. They won't take 50s now at major stores.
No, if you try to get $1,000, it's absolutely true. I recommend it to everybody. When you want to get $1,000 out of your own money out of the bank, you're a bank robber. I mean, they hate you. So there's proof, by the way, you should be doing it. We can just look at this medium that we're talking on right now, the internet. I mean, there's no doubt in anybody's mind, if the government had known what the internet was going to be, they would have outlawed it. And of course, right now, they're attacking it in many ways.
Senator Rockefeller said that a few years ago in the Senate.
Well, and Hillary Clinton said there should be government gatekeepers. decide who can get on the internet and so forth. But the internet outran the government, because the one thing we always have to remember about government, it's a very stupid institution. I think of it as like a huge blind dog. It's got vicious teeth. If one of the paws steps on you, you're dead. So it's very, very dangerous. But it's a stupid operation, and it's possible to outrun it. The market outruns it all the time. And the internet is doing it. So they're trying to hinder the internet. They're doing many things. But the internet people and the millions and millions, hundreds of millions of people involved in the internet at one level or another are fighting back. And I was delighted to see that Kim.com, the great internet entrepreneur in New Zealand, who was arrested by a SWAT team and now has been released because he lives in New Zealand, a freer country than this one, is going to come out with a new version of his mega upload site, and that's driving the U.S. crazy. I also noticed that Britain, for example, there's been a poor kid with Asperger's that the U.S. has been trying to extradite from Britain for 10 years. They want to put him in one of these federal high-security solitary prisons for the rest of his life for the crime of having gone and looking for information on UFOs and the NASA computers. And, of course, actually for the crime of showing them up and showing that they had...
And I've heard him interviewed, and he obviously is you know, kind of an idiot savant, autistic. I mean, are we going to put the Rain Man in jail?
I want to say God bless his mother. You know, his mother is the one who's fought for him all these years and really is responsible for the fact that even the Cameron government, which is a tool of the U.S., finally refused to extradite him. They're not going to allow him to be extradited. So there are good things happening in the world as heroes like this kid's mother and all the people who are fighting for freedom on the internet and in markets. I always think, you know, I always hear people saying when somebody's been in the military, thank you for your service. Well, Alex, I thank you for your service. I thank all the business people for their service, all the people on the internet, all the people fighting for freedom. They're the ones I want to thank for their service.
And that was my next question.
They cannot be employed by the government, by the way.
Exactly. What do you make of the incredible disconnect that Obama would actually give a speech explaining how entrepreneurs didn't build it, when anyone with half a brain knows entrepreneurs are the spark of civilization?
Well, you know, I sometimes think that Obama is a boob, as well as a fascist, socialist, whatever it is in his ideology. I mean, he said something that actually hurt himself, got away from him. But that, of course, gave us a peek into his real view. I don't believe, by the way, that Romney's any different. And Romney may be smarter and more successful in private life than certainly Obama ever was. But Romney's a fascist, too. So I don't believe that, you know, these guys, the power elite, the oligarchs, the plutocrats, even though they hold vast business interests, they don't like new entrepreneurs either. They do everything they can through tax policy, other government regulations, to crush the new entrepreneurs who would be competitors to them. So this is the Republicans have this view too. But I was glad Obama said that, because it revealed a piece of his mind and a piece of his heart to everybody who wants to see it.
Well, it also shows from every Soviet or fascistic model, from Nazi Germany to later East Germany to Russia to China, the true movie, the lives of others, where it shows the East Germans controlling what playwrights can write. And if you want to be an actress, you've got to have sex with a local police commandant. That's what authoritarianism is they get to then dominate the artists, the thinkers. They get to tell us we didn't build anything. They get to tell us what they want. They're obsessed with controlling the spark of truly dynamic humans that makes them so angry. People that are really successful, we're going to be successful because we have talent and energy, and it's embarrassing to us to dominate someone. We want to empower people. When will good people start standing up and crushing the control freak slugs?
But you know, this is actually nothing new in the history of government. Caesar Augustus, you know, paid the best poets of his time, Virgil and Horace and Livy and the historians, to write pro-government propaganda. These are very talented people, and they did some very effective government propaganda. So this is, you know, then and now. But we have, of course, the U.S. government today. Forget Caesar Augustus or Hitler or Stalin or anything. This is the biggest, most powerful government in the history of the world. So to get a hold of this government, which has the which wants to be the government, is a much more dangerous thing.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about that when we come back. This is the best interview ever with Lew Rockwell. Stay with us. See, government wants to put out all these TV shows and movies. Have you noticed all the new ones? were the patriots, the gun owners of the terrorists, and Homeland Security's got to get them? Right as they say, oh, it was never about Al-Qaeda. It was about the American people. I want to cover a laundry list of things with Lew Rockwell in the time we have. I'm jumping in a lot because everything he says sparks like 100 thoughts I'm having and vice versa. If you want to talk to Lew Rockwell, 800-259-9231. We'll take a few calls before he leaves us. 800-259-9231. Questions specifically for him. LewRockwell.com. Amazing website. We link to their stories pretty much every day. It's a must. Must place to visit on the internet every day, just like drudgereport.com and others. Lew, you were starting to get to America wanting to be the world government and the mega banks that are in control of it wanting to be at the center of that power structure. And this is the Pax Americana. They're going forward with it, and they are butchering every known form of liberty and then publicly using Al-Qaeda in Libya and Syria. And then Hillary comes out and says 2 weeks ago, we've got to invade Syria with boots on the ground because they're with Al-Qaeda. And then, oh, Iran's with Al-Qaeda when the West runs Al-Qaeda and is funding them. I mean, and we've got to give our rights up because of Al-Qaeda. I mean, it is so over the top that I don't even know what to say. It's so crazy. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen government get into more of a delusional state where nothing even matches up. But more and more, I think that's part of the tactic to just get everybody used to this absurdist Alice in Wonderland Tea Party type deal.
I remember Gerhard Niemeyer, who was a great political science professor at Notre Dame, talking about in the Soviet Union what sort of an effect it had. The official lies has an effect on people to keep hearing these lies promulgated as truth. It has a bad effect. Now, in the Soviet Union, they didn't have, of course, what we have in this country. We still have a free media. We still have free websites. We still have free publications that tell the truth. But, yeah, they lie. Always assume they're lying, by the way. Once in a while, they tell the truth. It's very, very seldom. Look at, as you say, Hillary. The U.S. has been training Al-Qaeda in its Turkish Air Force bases for a couple of years before they sent them into Syria as the quote-unquote rebels. So these are guys from Chechnya. They're from various Arab countries, from North Africa. Many of them are Al-Qaeda, which is, of course, if we don't look at it as a group that was formed by the U.S. and the Saudis and Osama bin Laden and so forth to fight the Russians in Afghanistan, it's a ideological tendency. It's not an organization. And there are some of these people who belong to that ideological tendency, that sort of Islamist tendency. U.S. has trained them, armed them, sent them in, and continues to arm them, sent them into Syria to overthrow the last secular Arab government in the Arab world, the one non-Islamist government. Now, why is the U.S. doing that? Well, there are a number of reasons. It has to do with, of course, the empire. They want to control all oil. They want to control the entire Middle East. But they want to cause trouble. I mean, this is what the Romans were open about when they said to divide and conquer, to cause conflict, and then enable them to conquer and to rule. So the U.S. loves it when Al-Qaeda gets active in, quote-unquote Al-Qaeda, active in Libya or in Syria or whatever. They want trouble. They want to break up all these countries. They want to destroy them and so that the U.S. and its allies can rule.
But it's so weird.
And can also prevent the oil from getting to anybody they don't want it to get to.
Exactly. It's so weird to hear that, you know, my wife needs to be drug off to a private room to be grabbed on by somebody, or my kids do, or out in the open because Al-Qaeda. And I've just gotten to the point with the TSA. I'm going to make, you know, it known that I know this is all a hoax. And now TSA agents come out and say, we're all stealing. I stole a million in 1 year. I mean, it's just like, it's because who would want a job dominating and yelling at people all day?
Well, there are people like that. And they go into government and they rise to the top. There are people who like torturing other people. They're like people who are imprisoning other people. There are people who like beating up. There are people who like dominating and ruling. So this is the government. So it's why we want the smallest government possible. We want the least intrusive government possible, because these are bad people. These are not public servants. I'm not talking about every school teacher or postman. Obviously, there are decent people who work for the government. But the people who rise within the government, the people who get to be Janet Napolitano or whatever, these people are 100% evil. 100%. So if you don't want more of that kind of stuff, and of course this business of the feel up in the airports has nothing to do with quote-unquote security. It has to do with making you humiliated, making you obey, so that they can do anything to you, your wife, your children, anything, and you have to like it and smile at them and say, yes, sir. That's the purpose of that. And of course, they want to extend that through society. They like all of society to be like one of these airports, where one day you're supposed to look them in the eye, and if you don't look them in the eye, you're a terrorist. Another day, if you look them in the eye, you're a terrorist. You know, they keep switching their little protocols. So they want the whole country like the airport, with the uniformed thugs are ordering us around. And, you know, whether we call them the Stasis or the SS or the SA or the SD or the KGB or the NKVD, or there are people who love this kind of stuff and are happy to go to work for the government and to rise within the government. Good people do not rise within the government. Just look at what happened to Ron Paul. How wonderful he got to be a congressman, but when he tried to run for Senate, or of course when he tried to run for president, they stole the votes from him. They did everything possible to crush him and keep him out. And more proof that Ron Paul is a great man.
Yeah, you know, I've known Rand Paul for about 16 years, and I like a lot of things he stands for. He's one of the best people in the Senate, but some of his underlings and people... I've seen reports out, you know, some of the Campaign for Liberty people saying, hey, we shouldn't criticize the Bilderberg Group like Alex Jones. Well, Ron Paul is where I learned about the Bilderberg Group 20 years ago. So what's strange is that we see almost a attempt to get into Campaign for Liberty and all this. And then I don't want to be negative, you know, but I'm not going to sit here and watch something I helped build be infested by neocons. And I know Ron Paul's come out and said he's not going to endorse Romney, and I know that Rand has backed off some of his pro, you know, war stuff. I mean, listen, I'm not trying to bring up dirty laundry here, but I mean, you were Ron Paul's chief of staff. Have you had any little a bad taste in your mouth or anything about some of the things we've seen in and around Rand Paul?
Well, I think I must say I don't follow the other politicians. Ron Paul was I despise politics, even though I was once in regular politics before going straight. Ron Paul is, my one exception. So I tend not to follow other politicians. I don't do it.
It's just to hear some of the Campaign for Liberty, some of Rand Paul people going, this is how we win. We merge with the Republicans. No, this is how we get co-opted. And so I guess that's why you don't have anything to do with it, because that's where it leads.
The Republican Party is, of course, a corrupt and evil organization, just like the Democratic Party. I mean, they have different interest groups associated with them. They have different rhetoric, but there's no difference between them. And of course, we should be concerned with groups like the Bilderbergers or the Council on Foreign Relations or the Trilateral Commission or all these groups. When the power elite gets together for a secret meeting to talk about what our future ought to be, yeah, we ought to be concerned. And of course, you've been great about following these people. And trying to find out what they're saying, what they're planning, who belongs. It's very useful information. It doesn't mean that they're running the world, but they're part of the apparatus. No question that they're part of the
Well, sure, they're meeting with government. They're meeting with government to try to get government to give them sweetheart deals, and that's why there's a problem. But it's worse than that. It's that when we used to point it out, the media said it didn't exist and we were crazy. So, see, that's the big issue. We've forced this out in the open, Ron Paul, yourself, myself, and many others, and now that we've won that fight, that there are shadowy corporate crony capitalists who work with government, who are our arch enemy, now we're being lectured, well, okay, we should work with Bilderberg. You know, I mean, that's the type of stuff coming out.
Well, you know, I mentioned earlier that the government is a stupid organization. The people who aren't stupid, however, are these private interests, the power elite, the big banking families, the big industrial families, the plutocrats, you know, Soros, Kochs, and so forth. These families are very smart. And they're able to make use of government to their own benefit. It also massively grows the government and hurts the rest of us. But you know what? They couldn't care less because they're in it for money and power. And so that's the way they operate. But we have to be concerned, and we have to be concerned about these power elite groups. And it gives us a peek. Very power elite analysis, as Murray Rothbard always called it, is just essential to look at. Other people would call it conspiracy theorizing, but to look at who these groups are, what they're trying to achieve, the government officials they work with against the rest of us. It's very, very, it's very, very important. And it, again, doesn't tell us everything, but it gives us a peek into their evil nature, and maybe gives us a hint about what they're planning. And to the extent we can have hints about what they're planning, it helps us to to refute and to defeat what they're trying to do to us.
Well, I mean, look, they're saying we want a managed economy. We're going to pick winners and losers. And that is the antithesis of a free society. And as David Rockefeller's grandpa said, competition is a sin. John D. Rockefeller. And he said that over and over again in newspaper interviews. They want monopolies. And the Republican Party will never talk about that. The Democrats think all business is bad. The Republicans say, oh, it's all good. Let it do whatever it wants. Well, no, it's not good. If it comes in and puts regulations in that it's exempt to shut down its competition. I mean, it's so elementary. Let me ask you this, and then we're going to get into some of the other news topics and find out what's on your mind before we take a few calls. Lew Rockwell, where do you see all this going? I mean, if you have to stare out into the future with your considerable economic and historical research and gravitas, I mean, I read your writings every week and you know, astounding insight, and from all the amazing people you've worked with over the years, where do you see us going? I understand it's fluid. We're deciding the future ourselves. But seeing the current formations, obviously big conflict between liberty and tyranny. It's coming to a head. But where do you see it going if we don't defeat these people versus if we did kind of win the day? Because there have been times in history when we can get a grassroots brush fire to go where people really reject and kind of vomit out the control freak government demon.
That's right, because they are a minority. They're a small minority. We are the vast majority. Think of us as a big friendly dog that's got a bunch of fleas on it. We are capable of scratching the fleas off, and they are just fleas as compared to the big friendly dog of the people. So it is possible to do it, but what do I see coming? I'm afraid we see more war. It looks like they want to go to war against Iran. You know, they keep Obama as well as Romney as well as George W. Bush keep saying nothing is off the table when we go to war against Iran. What they're saying is we're prepared to nuke them. We're prepared to kill millions of people. And of course, they've never forgiven Iran for having tossed out the U.S. dictator, the Shah. You're not supposed to turn the clock back that way. Once the U.S. takes over a province, it's never supposed to be freed. And so they can't, of course, can't stand Iran for that reason. Economically, I think, you know, there are many things we can change. Things, you're exactly right. Things are fluid. We do have free will. We can change our ideas. We can change the future. But there are also economic laws, and what the Federal Reserve is doing in cahoots with the big banks and the big investment banks and so forth, in cahoots with the rest of the government, has been so dangerous, so harmful. There's never been anything like this in the history of the human race where we've had this kind of massive money creation by central banks all across the world. We've got very, very serious trouble ahead. That's destabilizing for the regime, at least for us. So I hope that we can turn it to our benefit in the sense that I hope we more and more, all of us, learn some economics. I hope that we learn something about what the power elite is doing, and we learn what ought to be done as versus what they are doing, and how why Ben Bernanke is such an unbelievably dangerous public enemy. I mean, and it's not only, you know, it was the head of the European Central Bank and the head of the Bank of Japan, and just go down the line, all these central bankers are some of the worst enemies mankind has ever faced. So they're doing horrendous damage to us. But if we can understand why that's bad, why they shouldn't exist, why central banking shouldn't even be here, why we need hard money, sound banking, honest banking, instead of the dishonest banking that we have today. We don't need a bankocracy. The banks rule Europe. They rule here. They toss out prime ministers and install their own in Europe. A guy like Mitt Romney has been a tool of the investment bankers, Goldman Sachs and so forth, since he was a young man. So, and of course, Obama got massive support from these investment banks, J.P. Morgan, Goldman Sachs, and all the rest of them. When he was running for office, he still gets massive support. So we need to learn about these people. We need to learn why they're economically so dangerous. But that's the first thing you have to learn. You have to study and read. Just start with Henry Hazlitt's Economics in One Lesson. Start with Murray Rothbard's What Has Government Done to Our Money? Or The Case Against the Fed? Or Ron Paul's great book on End the Fed. Read these books, and then you'll understand just what our enemies are doing to us. Then we have a chance of defeating them.
I want to go to calls, but let's quantify this. There's two different trains in history. There's the creativity, those that love freedom, those that like being honorable, free association, and they're gangs. gangs with flags, gangs, you know, writ large, what you were saying earlier, you know, gangs with a flag. And sure, you can have nations that are more pro-liberty that can fight off another tyranny, but then they always end up becoming what they were, you know, organized against. But people need to understand, it's not like we're going to have total victory over corruption, or it's going to have total victory over us unless we give in. Every little battle, every little resistance, demonizing these people right now with their acts, exposing them, exposing police when they're out of control, you know, then puts pressure on the bad ones. And so it's an ongoing battle. Every day is a pitched battle against this corruption.
And we always have to speak the truth. It's so powerful, just one person speaking the truth, they fear it, they hate it. And so whether we're talking about domestic oppression, international oppression, bankster oppression, crony capitalist oppression, warfare state, police state, TSA, all these things, speak the truth. They fear it, and of course that's the way you persuade other people too. Speak the truth, don't be silenced. Don't be silenced, don't be silent.
Let's talk to Craig in New York. Quick question, and then we're going to break. Craig.
Hello?
Yes, sir. You're on the air, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just got a question about the current presidential situation. Romney, if I remember correctly, on one of the mainline shows, talked about trying to like hunt down people with mental illnesses and cure them. It sounded like hunt them down and kill them or something. But either way, in the Book of Mormon, the Articles of Faith, verse 7, it says, we believe in the gift of tongues, prophecy, revelation, visions, healing, interpretation of tongues, and so forth. To me, a lot of religions do that. So that would kind of mean to all believers in God.
I know, I hear your question. Janet Reno said on 60 Minutes that everyone that believes in the second coming of Christ is mentally ill, and now they have the New Freedom Initiative where they want to drug half the kids rolling out. Your take on that?
Well, there was a great article, of all places, in the New York Times, great because of the information it contained, not because of its orientation, about how doctors are being encouraged to give all kids these psychoactive drugs, Adderall and Ritalin and so forth. And they were, of course, they portrayed the doctors were great, charitable, wonderful, compassionate. They get kickbacks from the drug companies. That wasn't mentioned.
And all kids need drugs.
They want to give everybody, put everybody on drugs. Absolutely. Just like they've got the rest of us on fluoride and who knows what else.
But it's so crazy. They're like, let's put all kids on drugs. It increases... And it admits that those speed drugs literally make the brain smaller physically and make the heart bigger. I mean, totally hurts these kids. Some of the side effects are death. And they're like, we're going to put all your kids on it. I mean, it's insanity. Overdrive to get to 4 or 5 more of your calls with Lew Rockwell, lewrockwell.com. You can see some of the latest tweets I've sent out, some pretty amazing photos at twitter.com/realalexjones. Be sure and follow us there. They get here at the end of the week. The new film I did with Joel Skousen on preparation, but also on the globalist takeover plan. It's really a film. It was going to be a presentation. That's available now. You can pre-order that. His new strategic relocation film. It's available at InfowarsStore.com. You've got a special event coming up this weekend, don't you, Lew Rockwell?
We do, Alex. It's the 30th anniversary of the Mises Institute, and we're going to be holding a conference on Friday and Saturday at Callaway Gardens in Georgia on war revisionism, on the truth about war, which is obviously an important topic. We have Ron Paul, Judge Napolitano, a lot of wonderful speakers, and if anybody's interested in it, you can go to Mises.org, M-I-S-E-S.org, our website. And also, if you become a member of the Institute with a $50 donation, you can watch this online streaming for as well, if you'd like to.
Oh, man, see, I wish I wasn't tied down here running my evil I Didn't Build It operation, because that's the type of thing I would love to go to. That's the type of thing that I would love to send a crew to be able to come back and have a boil down of. But that's the type of thing everybody should go give $50, because the way you counterbalance the other side, it's not even a counterbalance. I am so sick being someone who loves history because it's so entertaining, and that's why I got into it and then found out it was actually horrifying to hear how government makes things great and how government health care is great when we know it's a nightmare in Europe. Government always wrecks and ruins everything, and it's so dangerous, and I'm sick of hearing how it's going to fix everything.
Yeah, and of course, and they fix everything with bombs too, right? Of course, if you listen to them, it's fixing, you know, brought freedom to Libya, brought, you know, they always bringing freedom by killing people. So we're going to talk about how they lie consistently about their wars, just like they lie about everything else, and just how unbelievably damaging from the standpoint of economic prosperity, freedom, the decent life, civilization itself, these sorts of perpetual wars. The U.S. government engages in perpetual wars. It lies about them. We want to tell the truth.
All I know is I drove home last night at about 9:30 with my wife and children, and I had police rush up behind me three times, drive recklessly into the other lane, and they weren't even going somewhere. They just pull off in a gas station, and it was like Race Carville or something. And I know Austin police, and then I saw out in the county police. They aren't that bad compared to some areas, but you can just see the attitude and just government, more and more of them. But they're telling us they're going to do less and less duties, quote, helping us. They're just going to revenue generate.
Well, sure, they're going to give you a big ticket for texting or whatever. I remember hearing Ray LaHood, the transportation guy. What a great name for a politician, right, Ray LaHood. But anyway, somebody called him up. He was on C-SPAN, and they said, you want texting outlawed everywhere by the federal government. What about cops? They text. And he said, oh, the cops are specially trained.
So the they're actually passing laws. They passed one in Texas where they're exempt.
Yeah, but of course, this is why they become cops, because they become exempt from the law. This is the essential thing to remember about government. It's above the law. It uses the law as a weapon against the rest of us, but the law doesn't apply to us. So the things that are murder for private citizens and should be punished are war for the government. If it's kidnapping for us, it's conscription and the draft for them. If it's stealing for us, why, it's taxation. So the key libertarian insight is the government is not above the law. The moral law applies to the government just like it applies to us. The things that are wrong, Alex, for you and me to do are wrong for people. And just because they're wearing a government suit doesn't change that.
That sounds terrorist. I mean, FEMA told me George Washington was a bad man.
That's right.
Can you believe that in the actual training manuals, and we have video of it, They say George Washington and Thomas Jefferson are bad?
Well, they resisted the government. Can't have that happening.
But I mean, oh man, we're going to go to break. And listen, Judy, be ready, please, with a quick question. And then Mouse Link and Andrew, Tylen, there's too many to get to everybody, but we're going to get to a bunch of them. Real quick questions, Bam Bam with Lew Rockwell. We're going to be right back. Stay with us, Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.tv. There's so much good to fight for. Most people that work in the system are not even bad people. They've been brainwashed, and it's up to us to teach them their proper role. Lew Rockwell's our guest. Let's jam in a bunch of calls. Judy in Florida, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hi, Alex. I had two quick questions, if possible. One is, with all the information, all the facts that are linked to both 9/11 and the underwear bomber, if there was a concerted effort with all alternative media and it was relentlessly pushed, I mean, all of the facts surrounding those two situations, I mean, if it would not at least open up a fresh investigation. I mean, there's a lot of proof that points to the fact that...
Sure. No, I mean, they're scared of us exposing Oklahoma City, 9/11, the underwear bomber being gotten on the plane, protected. This latest guy that was going to bomb the Federal Reserve, turns out they protected this moron, Patsy. It's always the same story. Lew Rockwell, comments on that.
Well, all police states employ agent provocateurs, so they try to get... They pick, you know, some poor boob from Bangladesh, lonely, maybe not too high in IQ. They talk him into planting a bomb. They tell him how to make the bomb, which of course is not, it's just a fake bomb, not a real bomb. They direct him, they say bomb the Federal Reserve, and they protect him from being captured by any of the counterterrorism forces in lower Manhattan. He gets there to the Fed, he plants the phony bomb, then they arrest him for, terrorism. Well, who's the, so just like the old Russians, the Tsar secret police was famous for this, all secret police do this. They create these terrorist incidents in order to scare the people and say, we better give all power to the government. But I think this is not working anymore. I think that latest thing about against the Fed, which I think was aimed at people like us, by the way, Alex. This is why they're picking the Fed as a target, the New York Fed. I don't think it had the effect they want. I don't think people pay attention anymore. They don't look in the closet and under the bed for terrorists anymore like the government would like them to.
Well, sure. So I mean, it's actually, like, the poor Fed. I mean, I've predicted they would false flag the Fed. Let's go to Mouse Link in New York. You're on the air, Mouse.
Good day, gentlemen. My ears perked up when you were talking about not voting. It is something that we've been discussing here for the past few weeks, having followed the debates and whatnot. And I was just wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more on that. It seems to be kind of a taboo subject. You know, if you bring that up.
People are shocked when you talk about this. What? You know, not vote? We're trained from the earliest days in the government schools that it's our duty to partake in the sacrament of the government, which is voting. But first of all, your vote doesn't count. Even if the votes are honestly counted, and who the heck believes that, your vote doesn't count unless the election's won by one vote. It's a pain in the neck. And the government loves you to vote. It's very, very important that you vote. And people who don't vote bother the government. And in the old days, we used to talk about what if they held a war and nobody showed up? What if they held an election and nobody showed up? That would be a very revolutionary act. So if we have fewer and fewer people voting, bothers the regime, bothers the government, bothers the media. And by the way, you don't have to go waste your time in some horrible government line in front of a government machine in what's just a facade and just a baloney operation.
But I think their point is, then how do you change the system?
Well, you don't through it through politics. I mean, politics is the government's game.
Give political us a few examples of how you do it. Give us a few examples, Lou.
Well, I think we have to do it by, first of all, just mentally seceding from the government. I mean, you can do things like homeschool your children. That's one great way to do it. But if you just mentally don't give them your consent, if you don't do what they want, if you don't think that they're the source of truth, if you then talk to other people about this, and if you learn yourself the truth about economics, about history, about government false flags, and all the various things you can learn about, then you can be a source of truth and guidance to others. That's the way we change things, by changing minds, not by putting creep A as versus creep B in the White House. I mean, why would anybody think that would make any difference? It doesn't make any difference. If there ever were a president who was any good, believe me, he would not be in office for very long at all.
Lew Royal, thank you so much for spending time with us. Sorry to the other callers. Look forward to talking to you again soon. And
thanks, Alex.
Thank you so much. All right, folks, retransmission coming up as we break down the internal passports and the FEMA camp. Straight ahead. Government loves you. Remember, they're good people.